to present the flower bouquet to our first speaker, Mr. Kunal Ghosh. When we think of electrical and electronics engineering, one of the foremost things that comes to our mind is VLSI and embedded systems. Today, we have the digital and sign-off expert, director and co-founder of VLSI System Design Corporation, Mr. Kunal Ghosh, who holds a master's degree in electrical engineering from IIT Bombay. He specialized in VLSI design and nanotechnology. Prior to launching VSD in 2017, he had held several leadership positions at Qualcomm's Test Chip Business Unit and led the physical design and STF flow development of 28 nanometer, 16 nanometer test chips. At 2013, he had joined Cadence as lead sales application engineer for Tempus STE tool. Currently, he is also the training partner for FDP and non-FDP with EI City Academy, IIT Guwahati. He is famously known for his very popular training in physical design domain. He has hosted 28 online courses in various VLSI synthesis, physical design, STA, circuit design, and many more for digital chip design, all using open-source EDA tools on Udemy platform, which is taken by 20,000 plus students in 135 countries and in 42 languages. I would like to request Mr. Kunal Ghosh to come on the dais and deliver his talk on transforming the silicon industry through open source. So please.
I think mouse is good. Mouse is still on. That's fine. Good morning, everyone. I think you guys are very brave coming on a Sunday morning for a workshop, for a VLSI workshop. Really appreciate. You guys ready? So today there will be a lot of not much talks. It will be more of labs. It will be more of, you know, I'll show you things. It will be like a 3 hour. You watch films and you watch. You go to theaters and you watch films. So today will be like a film. You can better take this. So we'll watch a kind of, you know, labs and films and things like that, so that you get a picture of. So right now everyone has heard of the term VLSI, everyone has heard of the term chip and things like that. But today I'll actually show you a couple of things, at least a miniature version of what happens in the industry, and maybe you can just go back and extrapolate things whatever we do over here. Okay, so you need not do anything right now. If you have a paper and a pen, that should be good enough. I want everyone to watch the screen and just keep watching, just like you watch a movie. So when you go to a movie, you don't take down notes, right? When you go for a movie, so it is something like this. And at the end, we will have something surprising for all of you. So yeah, so the next 3.5 hours is all you just watch the screen. Topic is transforming silicon industry through open source. And as she introduced myself, my name is Kunal Ghosh. I've done my master's from electrical engineering from IIT Bombay in 2010. I'm pretty junior to Professor Saroj, Punit, who is sitting over here, and couple of industry people. So very junior, but yeah, still I have some decent amount of experience in the field of chip designing. I've spent quite a substantial amount of time doing different kinds of things in the area of chip design. So I've specialized in VLSI design and nanotechnology, and mostly my master's project was into lithography techniques. I'll talk about that. And a couple of papers which I have on my name. I was working as a research assistant with Professor Richard Pinto and Professor Anil Kottantharil. So my project was just to tell you a story. I was into lithography. I was into manufacturing. You know, the place where you have Intel, TSMC, where they wear these entire gowns. They go to the clean room area. And they do work on silicon wafers. So I was into manufacturing. Accidentally, I switched to design. It was not even my profile. I switched to design because of another project that I did at IIT Bombay. So under Professor Madhav Desai. So anyone has heard of the processor called as Ajit processor? Ajit processor, yeah, from Mumbai. So Professor Madhav Desai is the one who has actually made that processor. So India has released two different processors. Of course, CDAC, if you exclude CDAC from the institutes, India has released two different processors. One is called a Shakti It's a national program by IIT Madras, and one was Ajit. So Professor Kamakoti was, I worked with Professor Kamakoti this year and last year at IIT Madras. And with Professor Madhav Desai, I had got an experience about the IR project, because in 2007 to 2010, when I was working with him, the IR project had just started. So we were a part of that. And now it has taken shape to called as Ajit Processor. And I'm doing something else. And apart from that, while I was in, so the first paper that you see, that was with Professor Madhav Desai. And the second, third, fourth paper are from my previous companies, Cadence and Qualcomm. And the last one is one of the flows which we have developed. So I will show you the flow also. So that flow is a part of the IEEE paper, and it was also selected in one of the conferences in China. Okay. A lot of boring stuff, right? Okay, I'll proceed. Some hands-on technology. You can just read it over, because you know some couple of things which I've done. And yeah, currently we have about 28 online courses. Now we have actually crossed 30 online courses, and it has been taken around by 21,000 students across 135 countries, and it's in 42 different languages. It's in Russian, Chinese, and all those different kinds of languages. Basically, it takes the speech and converts it into different languages, and that's how it has gone to. Okay, so now we'll start with the real thing. Okay, now real workshop. So enough of boasting about myself. Let's talk about real things over here. So everyone has seen this this kind of Arduino board, right? So you basically plug this on your laptops, and you can program this entire chip that you see on the screen. So technically, if I want to start designing this Arduino board, so there is one of the projects that we did with IIT Madras. It was about to start, so they wanted to replace. They wanted to replace that chip by some Indian processor, and that was the entire project that was started at IIT Madras. If I don't have this Arduino board, and if I want to design something, some board from scratch, what I'll do is I'll take a block of paper, and I'll try to keep things on the paper. I'll try to plan my city. So let's say if this was a city, I'm planning my city. So the processor is something which will sit at the center. And then let's say I want to communicate with the outside world. I need a path to contact to the outside world. And what you see on the peripheries, the blue lines, these are basically some of the peripheries. This is the GPIO. So if I want to share some input and output with things, say hi, Professor. Yeah, that's fine. So if I want to share some things from the outside world, I will use something called as GPIO. It's called it's a general purpose input output port. And then if I want to program something, I'll use some JTAG, or I'll use something called as UART. So you need not get into details of these terms. This will anyways clear. As in when we go further. But the idea is something. If you want to communicate to the processor, you have this particular peripherals from the outside world. If you want to enter inside the processor, these are something. This is something, the peripherals that you actually need. And this processor, so this is that particular processor that we are trying to design. And India has come up with two kinds of this kind of processors. One is Shakti and one is Ajit, which is by IIT Bombay and one is by IIT Madras. Okay, so that's how the significant this processor is. And this entire workshop or the next 3 hours will be looking into how do we design this particular small chip. That's the whole idea. And what happens once we enter this particular chip? How does this particular chip looks from inside? And how do you take things from inside to the outside world? So we'll talk a lot about those kind of things, and we'll do some labs. I'll show you how do you do design a small block. And the same thing can be extrapolated for designing a chip. Okay, so we'll start with this one. Let's say a chip has got a, so generally we have heard of a term called as ICV. We generally called as a non electronics engineer, anything we see on a board, we call it as an IC. But from today onwards, we will call it as a package. So because generally as a VLSI engineer, we call them as a package. We don't call them as IC or chip, which is something which is deep inside this particular thing. But this thing, what you see on any electronic devices, whatever you see, that let's call it as a package from now, because that's how a VLSI engineer or how an electronics engineer should relate to different things. Okay, so this is no more an IC for you; it's a package for you. And the package has got certain dimensions. It will be like, say, one of the examples which we use. So this was one of the one of the chips that was taped out this year itself in with X-Fab Germany. So it was about 48 pin package. You will see a lot of pins on the you will see 12 pins on each side, and it is called as quad flat no lid. So we have seen different kinds of ICs, or let's say we'll talk about ICs. One ICs for which the pins comes out. You must have seen those chip and the pins comes out. And this is the different kind of chip or a package for which the pins are internal. They don't have some leads, but they are just a package which you can just sit on the PCB. So that's basically called as the package. And the chip is somewhere sitting at the small area inside the package. Now our job is to take this particular chip and connect it to the outside world. Okay, so there are a couple of things we need to do over here. We need to first of all design this particular chip. Okay, we need to make sure that the chip functions the way it's supposed to be function. And then this pins what are there at the outside, at the peripherals of the chip, needs to come outside the to the outside world. So is that till this point? Is this part pretty much clear? Or for the people who just joined. So people at the back, you can come at the front. There's a lot of spaces over here. Because in the further labs, the fonts might not be pretty much clear. We just tested. We just did a small test before joining. So you can just. So if you sit in the front bench, don't be scared. I'll not ask questions, so it's fine. Okay, good. So this is what we are going to do. So what you see, that blue box over here, that is what we are trying to design. And then we are going to connect that blue box to the outside world. Okay, that's the task of a chip designer or a chip engineer. It looks easy. It took 9 years. It almost took about 9 to 10 years to design one chip. Okay, so I'll expand this particular chip. I'll just expand the chip and to get more detail or deep dive inside this particular chip. So basically, if you see the sides over here, this has to be a bit at a wider side, because you need to connect this. These are basically called as pads, and these are the pads which basically connect to the outside world. So you have to connect. You have to connect these ones to these ones. So you need some bigger area to connect those wires to the pad. So that's why this is basically called as the. So these are basically called as the pads. Okay, for now, these are called as the pads. And generally, whenever you go outside and whenever you read some of the papers, these are the common terms and terminologies that you will be using once you enter into this particular field. This area where your actual core, so we know about AND gates, OR gates, flip flops, and things like that. Those things actually sits at the center that you see over here in this particular area. And the area of the chip is defined by the die. So the die is something which actually goes on a silicon and gets fabricated. I'll talk about that once we reach there. But this is the area where your actual core logic sits, and this is the area. This is what defines the area of the die. Okay, so this is basically called as the die. This is the core, and these are the pads. This should be pretty simple words to catch up. These images should be actually, if you take a look at these images, I think they should speak a lot more than what I speak, because this should capture things just as it has to be. It has to get captured. So that's now we look into the core, and we look into some of the components of the core. So let's say a core can have a SoC. It can have a RISC-V. I'm talking about RISC-V because I'll show you how does the RISC-V world looks like. In a bit of introduction about RISC-V, it can be ARM processor, it can be x86, it can be SPARC processor, SPARC based SoC, or things like that. But I'll take an example of RISC because my expertise is on RISC. So it this is basically something called as RISC-V SoC. SoC is basically a system on chip. It's generally we in the VLSI world we call it as a SoC. And it will have something memory. So if you want to communicate with the outside world, the way the processor works is it puts something in the memory, and the outside world takes it from the memory. If you want to push some data inside your chip, you have to put it in the memory, and the memory then pushes the data inside the RISC-V SoC. There's a lot of things that happens within that, but in a layman's term, it's basically memory places an interface between your processor and the outside world. Anything if you want to talk to the outside world, you put it in the memory, and the outside will pick it up. It's basically works like that. So that is basically memory, and then now analog. So basically all of our entire world, if you look into this 220 volts AC, these are all analog ports. There should be some mechanism to convert those analog to digital signal. So that's why every chip will have something called as ADC or DACs. Okay, that is basically what you see in the on the, so these are the basic components. If you remember these basic components, anything can be anything can be built using these basic components. So, and then you need a PLL. So basically, if you want to clock, so all the chip, all the components. So right now, if you decide on a time over here, so 9 o'clock was the time, that was a clock time that everyone needs to be in sync in this particular room. Similarly, the chip also functions in that way. It needs a clock. Okay, and the clock is being generated using PLL, so that you see over here, and this basically provides the clock to the entire chip. So basically, it basically tells that everyone should be on time. They should come on time, not at 9:20 or 8:40. It should be not 9 o'clock. That's basically. So even the chip also follows the same whatever principles we follow in our real life. The same principles are followed by a chip as well, and this is the one that generates the clock, and there's another small block. It's basically called as the interface. It's a serial interface just to send take in data and send it out. So these are the basic components of how does general purpose processor looks like. It will have a EDC, it will have a DAC, it will have a memory, it will have a processor. These are the 5 to 6 basic components. So tomorrow, if you go for a VLSI interview, and let's say you don't know anything about VLSI, and they ask you what are the basic components, if you talk about this one, the interview will feel like, okay, you know a lot of things. So just take a note of this term, so that tomorrow when you go for an interview, you can just talk about this terms, and I think that should do the job for you. I've done that many times. There are topics which I didn't know anything, but in my 2008, 2009. When I didn't know anything about those topics, but I was pretty confident about the terms which I had heard in some conference or something like that. And the way we talked about those terms confidently from the interviewer, you know, that creates a different impression. So yeah, these are some of the non-technical tricks which you can follow. All right. So these are basically called as the IP. So every foundry is, for example, in India, we have a foundry called as Semiconductor Chandigarh Limited, SCL. That's in Chandigarh. We have Intel. Intel has got its own foundry. TSMC has got its own foundry. Then Samsung has got his own foundry. Every foundry will have their own blocks. Will have their own blocks, and they are basically called as an IPs. So, for example, if I decide to manufacture my chip with let's say SCL, I'll show you in labs also how do you basically connect to respective foundries. It's there in my labs. So if I want to tape out, if I want to manufacture a chip using, let's say, Semiconductor Chandigarh Limited, I'll take all of the blocks that you see over here from SCL. If I decide to tape out this chip from let's say, Intel, I'll take all of these blocks from Intel itself. If I decide to tape out this chip from TSMC, I'll take all these small blocks from TSMC. It's like a manufacturing unit. And those are basically called as foundries. And the blocks that you see over here, which is being given by the foundries, those are basically called as IPs. Okay, so these are basically called as the foundry IPs. Okay, that part is this part clear? The terms that we are going to getting introduced to this one, and this will be pretty much more clear when we go to the labs. The labs will explain how do you connect a design. So basically, you have one particular design and you want to manufacture that design, and how do you connect that particular design to a foundry? I'll show that everything in the labs. It will be very much clear. Right now, just look into the images, and that should give you an idea about a couple of things. These are basically called as the macros. Again, we'll hold that term for now. So macros is basically some blocks which you want to implement separately. I'll talk about once we go in the labs. But just make a note of the term that these are basically called as the called as the macros. Okay. And now basically, if I want to draw a real connection, how does a complicated chip looks like? This is fairly this is how the basically the chip connections and the routes will look. So there are signals that are getting connected from the boundary. So if you look over here from the boundary, the signals come and go and they enter into the chip in a different way. So this is how a complicated chip looks like. But this is a minimal complicated chip. It is about only the 30,000 instance count. And we have designs which has got about 10 billion or 1 billion or 10 million instance count in that range also. So this is a very, very miniature version of the complications that you will be seeing in the real world. This chip took us about 15 months to 20 months for tape out. And this was done using one of the foundries. Again, we'll talk about foundries. So there is another foundry in Germany. It's called XFAB. So this chip was taped out over there using open source EDA tools. Okay, and that was done by one of the companies called eFabless. But I was mostly involved into the benchmarking of the tools. Okay. So now let's look into a couple of let's look into how does things basically start from here. So what is a RISC-V SoC? So if you look into, everyone on the laptops has got this applications like Mozilla, Oracle, and things like that, the PowerPoint and all. These are basically called as application software. And all these application software are either written in C, C++. The base language is either C, C++, Java, or those basically high level programming languages. But in reality, all these applications needs to work on this particular hardware. So what do? You need something at the center, something at the between that will convert those languages, those high level languages, into a language which will be understood by the chip. So chip and your digital circuit, they understand only two languages, ones and zeros. They don't understand anything other than that. So there should be a mechanism to convert the application softwares to ones and zeros. Okay. And that mechanism is basically done by something called as architecture. I'll talk about once we go. So basically on my laptop, the architecture is basically Intel x86. On your mobile phones, the architecture is basically called as ARM. It's you have an ARM processor, so ARM does all this kind of conversion. There is another architecture that is coming up that's basically called as it's basically called as RISC-V, which is the domain that I've been working on for a couple of months. But the concepts, the basic concepts remains the same. So that's what it does. So everyone has done this ATD5 microprocessor from Gaukar, right? Gaukar book, ATD5 microprocessor, semester 3, semester 4, I think somewhere. So you must have heard of those assembly language programming. You must have key. So that's basically an Intel architecture. So whatever you see the assembly language, that's an Intel architecture. So whatever applications, let's say if you had that 885 microprocessor with you and you were running some application, let's say Mozilla, Firefox and all. So there is an interface, there is an operating system which converts that Mozilla, Firefox, all those high level languages into your 885 add, subtract, command instructions and jump instructions and things like that. And then that gets executed on your processor. So that's basically the flow. And I'll show you that in a couple of minutes. So this is the flow. Basically, you have a system software which converts all the application high level languages into bits. Basically, first of all, it converts into instructions. And instructions could be, for example, ATD5, it was add, subtract instructions. And for RISC-V also, it is very similar, but I'll show you the exact instructions. And those instructions are basically then converted into bit patterns using something called as assembler. So these are mostly software terms. So if anyone over here from the software background, you will be able to relate to this particular terms. But in an entirety, this is the entire flow. So let's say stopwatch. Let's say take an example of a stopwatch. If this was a C program of the stopwatch, is it visible? Yeah, it is visible from the back. So there's a C program for a stopwatch, for example. And then if you take that particular C program through a RISC-V compiler, for example, then this is how the code looks like. If you see over here, I think I need that. Yeah. If you see over here, so this is a C program for any software. For example, in this case, it's a stopwatch. This C program is getting converted into some of the assembly language program, which you see over here. So you can think of this as an 885 add subtract instructions. And these are the basically binary, the opcodes. You must have in the 885, you must have looked into these opcodes and all. You punch in the opcode in that particular 885 kit, and then you get look into the output. So these are basically the opcodes, and this needs to be executed in this particular. And this particular opcode needs to go inside this chip, and this chip now should be able to give you produce results what is expected when you double click on a Mozilla Firefox or when you want the stopwatch to work. Okay, so that's the entire process. Okay, is that part clear? So this is how things have been working till now. Even if you open a mobile phone, whatever apps you are running, this is the flow. This is basically the process that it continuously keeps on doing. Back and forth. It does it millions of times in a second. We don't even know about it. It is so fast. Okay. So is that flow clear? So better is I'll show you one of the examples. So let's say I'll just cover this one, and then I'll show you one small example. I'll run it on the screen and show you how does things look like. So this is the C code of one of the stopwatch. And this is basically what you see on the right is the entire assembly language instructions of one of the architecture, in this case RISC-V, and then this is basically called as, so what you see over here, there is an interface from the C program to the hardware, and that interface is basically called as the it's basically as an abstract interface. It's basically called as the instruction set architecture, or it's basically called as the architecture of the computer. The architecture of my laptop is x86. The architecture of some of the of your phones, it's ARM architecture. And there are some IoT area which are looking for not that complicated instruction sets or not that easy instruction sets. So they are looking somewhere in mid. So they are trying to focus on something, a new instruction set. It's called as the RISC-V architecture. So that's the role of an architecture. Okay, that's basically called the architecture of your computer. Okay. Now from this part to this part. So now you have that. I have this particular instructions. You have this add commands, subtract commands, and things like that. They have to now go and sit inside this particular chip and run on this particular hardware. That's the whole goal of the entire chip design flow. So now this hardware will understand only ones and zeros. And for example, if you look into this particular binary bit pattern, this basically resembles a command called as add x6, comma x10, comma x6. So one of the add instructions, the bit pattern for that particular add instruction is this one. So hardware will understand this one. Okay. And what your compiler will give you this one. So it is a job of this particular behavior. So we have talked about Verilog netlist, and everyone has heard of the term Verilog or RTL. So Verilog basically the way Verilog has been written, it represents the behavior of something. So in this case, this particular Verilog netlist will represent the behavior of an add instruction, or basically in that matter, the behavior of each and every instructions present in the RISC-V architecture. Okay, so that's the starting point of your design. So you have a Verilog netlist, which is basically nothing but a netlist which replicates the behavior of different kinds of instructions that is present in an architecture. In x86, for example, if you are designing an x86 processor, so this particular RTL will represent or behave or basically model the behavior of an x86 architecture. In this case, since we are using the term RISC-V, this particular Verilog code, this whatever you see over here, it's a real Verilog code from one of the 32-bit microprocessor. So this Verilog code will represent or will model the behavior of one of the architectures. Okay, that's the job. So for example, if you're designing something called as vending machine, for example, vending machine is a very common example. The behavior netlist will describe the model, or the Verilog netlist will describe the behavior of a vending machine. Okay, vending machine is also an application. Similarly, this one will describe the behavior of your architecture. So whatever application was running over here, that will get converted into some instructions. These instructions will get converted into some bit patterns. And this particular RTL, this particular the Verilog netlist will understand this particular bit pattern, and it basically interprets that this bit pattern represents add instructions. And similarly, it will implement all the instructions, and when you click on that Mozilla Firefox, it will behave the way it is supposed to behave. Okay, so all these things happens in a span of seconds. All right, is that part clear? And then the second part is basically to convert the behavior, the whatever you see as a behavior. So behavior is like a C program. If you write an add addition program or a subtraction program, these are basically programs, C program. Kind of C program. Verilog is a kind of C program. So, but these are basically behavior, and what you see, what we have been learning in semester 3, semester 4 was logic gates. There is a subject called as digital logic and design, DLDA. Okay. So that subject we have learned about ALUs, we have learned about AND gate, OR gate, and things like that. So there should be a mechanism to convert the behavior to gates, and that mechanism is basically called as the synthesis. So whatever this gate, whatever you see over gates over here, the AND gate, OR gate, and things like that, the arrangement of those gates will be in such a fashion that this will basically represent the behavior of your Verilog netlist. And finally, there should be a mechanism to put everything, to put all of them on a chip, and that's basically called as a physical design implementation. And that's basically the entire flow. We look into the labs, and then there are some more theory that I want to cover. Is this part clear? How do you start from an application software, and then how do you reach to bits, ones and zeros? And that's technically that's the flow. More or less, the flow remains the same for any kind of application that you see these days. Okay, is that part clear? Okay, so what I'll do is I'll quickly show you one of the labs. So what we'll do is we'll have a small C program, and that will make things much clearer. Okay, so for example, the basic hello world, that's the basic C program which I can cover over here. There are a couple of more complicated programs which I have, but there is a project that is going on with IIT Guwahati, where IIT Guwahati has created a tool. They've written a tool in C++, and that basically, anyone has done the MOSFET, transistors are covered in the BTEC courses, MOSFETs. So MOSFETs, you must have seen this drain current, gate voltage and things like that. So IIT Guwahati has came up with a tool to model the device. And basically that it's very similar to what you do something called as, so there is a separate field in the VLSI, it's called device modeling. So if you want to basically model a particular device, if you want to generate the IDVD curves, you do it in SPICE. That is one way. But then there is another field which actually, so SPICE looks into the models which are taken from the you look into the model files. So there is a tool which generates the model file. So IIT Guwahati has actually developed those model files in the C++ code. And there is a work that is going on which will convert that C++ code into a RISC-V architecture. So that is that is one of the works that is going on with IIT Guwahati. So think of this particular C code as that big C code, which we're trying to, or this is basically a base C code for a Mozilla Firefox or something, some C code, which we're trying to convert into an assembly language program. Okay, so let's look into that. So it's very simple. It's like, anyone who has done the C programming, it is one of the printf lines and return zero and just a basic C language. Now, so for example, now what I'll type over here, something called as, so everyone has done this one. Just look into the screen. Everyone must have done this part. Yeah. So once you type this, it will generate a binary. It will generate some binary, then you do compile that binary and it will basically print out what is. So this line basically keeps me going on. I use this line. So these are very good stimulus. If you write these particular lines in front of your, the place where you study or the place where you work, this actually stimulates your brain. There's some science behind it. Just write out it. It works. It has worked well with me. Okay, so everyone knows about GCC, things like that, right? Similarly, there is, so everyone, every architecture, for example, x86, for example. I'll pull it up, yeah. Oops, okay. No, what I'll do is, I'll do like this. Yeah? Huh? This is clear, right? Okay, yeah. So now, so next is basically every architecture. Now we know that what architecture is, x86 or MIPS or ARM, or so every architecture will have their own compiler. Okay, I'll show you an example of how does a RISC-V compiler works. So for example, I'll type this one command. So it's basically appended by RISC-V 64, but it's a GCC compiler. All the options for GCC will work for the RISC-V compiler as well. So I'll use this command. I'll type the same command. I'll compile this one and generate something called as hello.o. Okay, for example. Now I'll run this. So if you see over here, it will create it will create a file called as hello.o. Very similar to a.out, but in a RISC-V format. Now this was the original x86 format because my laptop is x86, and this is basically a RISC-V format. Okay, and now I'll try to create. Now do you look? Can you see this entire thing? What do you see on my screen? So this is basically a C code. This is basically an assembly language code in the RISC-V format for just printing that particular hello world. I'll show you another thing. There's something. So the way we used ./a.out, and in over here in the RISC-V world, there is something called as Pike. And other tools, other compilers will have their own way to compile things. So if I use Pike and use the same thing, hello.o, it will print me the same thing, the same line. So one was done using a GCC regular compiler, and one was done using a RISC-V, one of the RISC-V compiler, and both give me the output as same output. Okay, so that's basically, that is what is it is supposed to do. So anything which runs on GCC, it should be able to run on a similar compiler. And now if you look into the, the assembly language of that small print statement, it will look something like this. It will be a huge list, and the reason is basically it is basically covering everything. So when I say covering everything, it is covering all of this. It is covering basically all of the operations that you see in the system software, and for printing that one statement, it will create a bunch of assembly language program. So this actually goes into your hardware. It runs this particular hardware and gives you and prints you back that hello world, the hello world statement. Okay. So this is a huge file. It will have all the system level assembly language programs also. Okay. Now there should be a hardware. So there should be a chip that understands this, whatever you see. So this is the ADDI, for example, if this is the ADDI instruction, this is the bit code or the opcode for that particular ADDI instruction. There should be a hardware which understands this bit, this opcode, this particular code, and executes ADDI instruction. There should be a hardware which understands this jump instruction, and which understands this particular opcode and executes the jump instruction. There should be the same hardware, the same chip should be able to understand this load instruction, should be able to understand this particular opcode. So this is basically a hexadecimal pattern. So if you expand 6 in hexadecimal, it will be 0110. If you expand 9, it will be 1001. It's all bit patterns over here. So when I give this bit pattern to my chip, the chip should be able to understand that it has to execute load instruction. Okay. So that's how things work over here. Okay. Is this part clear? Now we are going to look into a chip which actually does this. Okay. Is this part pretty much clear? Yeah. No? Not yet. I haven't converted. I'm just simulating my architecture. Over here? Huh. Yeah. So the question is, why do I need a Verilog netlist over here? So basically all of this, whatever you see over here, that's running on a hardware. It's running on my laptop. Yeah. So the laptop or the chip should understand what it's running. The lap. It doesn't create. We create the Verilog. Yes. Yes. So basically so the way it works is this particular hardware, whatever you see over in the right side. So this assembler and your software has done its job. It has created this bit pattern. Now somebody should take this bit pattern and give you response. Who is going to execute this particular bit pattern? This bit pattern should go somewhere. It should execute that bit pattern and respond and give you a written response. So this chip will take this particular bit pattern. It will implement the add instruction based on the bit pattern. It will give you the results, and it will give the results back to your OS. That's how you see the Mozilla Firefox coming up on your screen, or PowerPoint coming on your screen. So you double click on the PowerPoint. When you double click on the PowerPoint, all these things happen. So the processor is an RTL. The processor itself is an RTL. The processor is a, it's not existing. I'm modeling the processor. Yeah. It's modeling. Yeah. So the question is this assembly language program, where is the Verilog is getting created? So basically I was explaining the flow of how does things work. So when you design a processor is designed to understand this part. Okay. So what is running over here? This hardware has to return back, respond to that instructions that are model of the architecture is in my Verilog. Yeah. So what we were discussing over here, what is the, basically the job of the Verilog? Yeah. You have a question. That some of the it's a bootloader. We'll talk separately. It's a different topic. So for example, if you want to Arduino board, if you want to boot it, there should be some internal script that should be running. That's basically called as the bootloader. That will it's a startup code. It basically starts your I will talk separately about the bootloader. Yeah, good question. We also do a workshop on RISC-V, specifically RISC-V software part. That's interesting. Yeah. Anyone has any questions? Or shall I ask some questions? Okay. So is this part clear? Is this till now? What is the inception of the Verilog? Where is the inception of a behavior Verilog netlist comes into picture? Okay, and these are basically our labs part where we covered all the labs in detail. Okay, so coming back. So a question for the backbenchers, which was the slide number I was doing? 52, yes, it was 52. Okay, so I'll now take you inside an SoC, inside a real SoC, and this is how basically one of the SoC. So one of the examples of the SoC looks like this. Is basically a small SoC called as a Pico SoC. It has got a processor. It has got, so what you see over here, that's the Verilog netlist. That's a Verilog. I'll show you. I'll open this Verilog and show you. This is the Verilog which models the architecture. So we're talking about modeling the functionality of the architecture, right? So this is basically what models the architecture of the instruction. And as I said, every SoC, if you want to communicate with the outside world, it should have a memory. It should have a memory, and then you should have some peripheral interfaces. So this is basically UART and SPI. So these peripherals are used to communicate with the outside world. Okay. So typically, most of the SoCs, the complex ones or the simple ones, the basics remain the same. It will have a processor and a memory and some peripheral interface and analog ADC and DAC. Though these components will not change. Apart from that, there will be some. So in recent chip design, there will be something called as accelerators. So it's called as AI accelerators. So I'll talk separately about that. It's basically like 3-4 years back, they were doing AI all using software. But now they realize that AI is much faster if you put the AI part in, if you model the AI part in terms of a Verilog and put it in the hardware itself. That's basically, in a general layman term, it's called as AI accelerators. So now your SoC has got a lot of AI accelerators also. So when I talk about AI accelerator or machine learning algorithms and all, so software has done its job, but software is generally slower compared to hardware. So if you do something on software has to again follow that flow. It has to convert into assembly language program, bit pattern, go to the chip, go back and come back. So that flow is pretty much a big flow for a software to do. So for all the AI related applications, they are now converting that software itself into real Verilog netlist. And they are basically putting that Verilog netlist inside the chip. So that becomes, that makes things a bit faster. That's basically called as the AI accelerators. IIT Madras is working on a lot of AI accelerator part. If you go to a website called as, it is called as Padhai, PADH.AI. That's basically a startup by IIT Madras. It generally educates more about AI accelerators and how does your SoC looks like and things like that. Okay, it's a very good site. Go for PADH.AI. They do some very good, I think, 3-month courses on AI accelerators. And IIT Madras has got their own research park. So and they have their company set up in the research park. So whoever does the course, they actually hire a couple of people as an intern for that, for their research over here. So just go to it. The students, the people who created that website, they are from IIT Bombay. They are IIT Bombay, my batchmates. So they were my batchmates in 2009-10. They went to US, did their PhD and came back to IIT Madras as professors. And they have created this particular website just to motivate a lot of AI accelerator work inside India. That's an India initiative by government. And part of it is by government and part of it is by IIT Madras. So just have a look into that part. So the point was, most of the software work is now moving to hardware. But you cannot put a lot of software work inside the hardware because your chip will start looking bigger. Because if you want to maintain a size of a mobile phone, if you want to maintain a size of a laptop, you can't do you can't go beyond certain size. So you have to maintain, you have to optimize the size of the chip in such a fashion that you put a lot of hardware, but you don't put enough hardware. Some of the things you push to the software, and some of the things you put in the hardware. So that's the part. So go to, if you find, go to that particular website. So these are how typical SoC looks like, RISC-V. So this is when you see 32 over here, it's basically a 32-bit instruction. If when you see 64, it's a 64-bit instruction. So it's basically in 8085, it was 8-bit, right? 8085 add command, subtract command, those are all 8-bit, right? Yeah. Similarly, in this case, in case of RISC-V, it's 32-bit. So there are two parts to it. The one is 32-bit and one is 64-bit. So they have both a variety of instructions over here. In this case, what I'm showing over here, it was designed for handling 32-bit instructions. So this is how basically a RISC-V SoC thing looks like. Now that we know that the relation of software and the hardware and we know the flow, now we will assume that we have a model of the behavior of the RISC-V in one of the Verilog netlist, and we'll try to implement that Verilog netlist or convert that Verilog netlist into a chip level. When that Verilog netlist has to go on a chip, how does that particular thing looks like? Okay, that is the part that we are going to do. So we'll abstract out the other part. So everything that you see over here, this is one separate domain. It's a software domain. This is basically called as a front end domain. This part is basically called as the back end domain. Mostly my expertise come from I did my master's, which comes after this one, which is into manufacturing. Okay, in my Qualcomm, I was into physical design and this part, and basically this particular part. At Cadence, I was mostly into the analysis of this one. At IIT Madras, I was into the software and the hardware. So it is basically, I've done something of everything. It's like jack of all trade, master of none, kind of thing. Okay, so it's basically bits and pieces. We have done a lot of things because kind of projects that we were getting for our company. So that's why we had to know all of things, and we had to deliver this thing. So that's why we have a fair amount of background of about everything. So this is basically your software. This is basically your front end, and this part becomes your back end. And every domain has got its own flavor, its own variety of jobs. Okay. So what we'll do is we'll take up so behavior looks something like this. So a Verilog netlist will look something like this. It will have the top level module name. So in this case, I am using SPI, or in generally, if it was an Intel x86, the top level module name will be called as Intel x86. If it is an ARM, it will be called as this one. Module will be called as ARM, and these are basically the ports. So this particular thing defines which is the input port, which is the output port, and which are the registers. This is basically a general definition of how do you model any behavior in a Verilog, and it's a very demanding language. And there are some statements over here. So this is basically how we represent the behavior of anything. So this is basically a kind of a flip flop. So we all know how does a flip flop work. Whenever the clock, whenever it hits the clock, it delivers the data at the output, and whenever at the latch. So latch is something which works on the level. Flip flops works on the edge. This is basically an edge. If you see pause edge or pause edge, this is basically kind of a flip flop kind of thing. Okay, so this is basically how you model whatever you see on the screen. AI accelerators. If you talk about AI accelerators, this particular hardware will model how does an AI behave, how the AI software behaves. And now there are mechanisms where actually you can take up a C language, C code, and convert it into RTL. So it's basically there was one of the code which was developed by IIT Bombay was called as Ahir. Ahir was a tool which took in the C language and generated the and it developed the Verilog netlist output at the output. So there are you need not start from the Verilog itself. There are places where you can actually abstract out a couple of things. You can write your code in C or C kind of languages. So a couple of latest languages which I can tell you is there is something called as Chisel. Chisel was developed by Berkeley. It is again C kind of languages. There is something called as BlueSpec. BlueSpec is again that's again that is what IIT Madras has used for developing Shakti, and there are a couple of high level languages. You can use those languages to define your functionality. You need not go into the details of Verilog because right now these parts are all abstracted out. There are tools which converts the high level language to the Verilog netlist, and you write all your code in a C like language. So if you know C or C++, you can very well generate your own hardware and then use the tools, use some open source tools to convert the C language to your hardware language. Those things are all available. Okay, so this is what you see on the screen. Like about I think 15 years back, they used to write all your codes in directly in Verilog, but now the complexities of the chips have become so high that you tend to miss some of the details in the Verilog. So they write all of them in the C like languages, and then there is an interpreter or converter which converts a C to Verilog. So there are things like that, but from a student point of view, you should be knowing what Verilog consist of, because mostly the questions that you will be getting in your interview or basically at the end, you're going to debug the Verilog netlist itself. So you need to know what Verilog is and how does it basically looks like. Okay, this is basically your starting point. And your PNR tools, the tools that are used for chip designing, it understands this format. So anyways, you have to understand what's Verilog is. Okay, is that part clear? So the first step is basically to convert the behavior, what you see over here. So behavior doesn't have any gates. It doesn't have AND gate, OR gate, or things like that. And what a real chip needs, it needs our digital logic design topic. It needs muxes, it needs AND gate, it needs OR gates and things like that. So there should be a mechanism to convert the behavior into a gate. And that mechanism is basically called as the logic synthesis. So that part is basically covered over here. It's basically called as the logic synthesis. All the behavior that you see on the Verilog netlist, I'll show you. So this entire part, I'll basically convert this entire behavior into the logic synthesis. And this is basically now, this is where your foundry comes into picture. So when we talk about Intel, foundries like Intel, TSMC, Semiconductor Chandigarh Limited, or Samsung. So till this point, you're writing your behavior code, the foundry, the manufacturing unit doesn't come into picture. Now it's where your manufacturing are now entering into your domain. That's basically how the manufacturing industry comes into picture. The first step is basically convert all your behavior into one of the foundry IPs. So remember, we talked about foundry IPs. The gates are also called as the foundry IPs. They are one of the foundry. So if let's say if I want to convert my behavior, I want to manufacture my chip to in Intel. What I'll do, I'll take this particular behavior, I'll connect it to Intel foundry and generate a netlist which is being understood only by Intel foundry. Okay, think in a broader terms. So once you, so let's try to do this in the labs, and you know it will be very. So again, the slide number, just remember the slide number. Okay, that will be a quiz question after this. What's the slide number? Okay, good. You are awake now. Okay, so we'll take one of the we will take some of the RISC-V. All we'll take a small block. Let's see, what do I have? Okay, so this was one of the cores I was working just last night. Last night we had a customer who was working on, with whom I was working. So let's continue with that chip itself. So anyways, I was working on it. So what I'll do is so the steps basically is the steps are pretty easy. Now you know you have the behavior with you in terms of Verilog, and you have the foundry with you. There should be a mechanism to connect the foundry to the behavior Verilog netlist. Okay, so let's do that. So I will type a command, kubeflow. So what you see on the screen, this is one of the tools, and all these tools can be actually installed in your own laptops, and your laptop will become a potential lab for you. So so there is a way. I have an online. I have an online free course where I explain how do you install all the open source tools. How do you install Linux, first of all? Because mostly most of the students will have Windows laptop. So from Windows, basically you keep the Windows in the background. Or how do you install VirtualBox, and how do you install tools inside your VirtualBox, and how do you run these labs on your laptop? So all those things are getting covered in one of the online courses. I'll point you to that. And once you have all the setup ready, each and every laptop will be like a potential lab for all of you. Okay. So you not go to your basically you not hunt for labs. You can just actually use your laptops to do all this. Whatever we saw in the last couple of minutes, you should be able to do everything in your own laptop. Okay, so I'll show you that. So is this visible at the back? Is this visible? Let me see. Okay, is this now visible? Yeah, so I'll do one thing. This is good. This is good. Okay. So, so first step is to basically connect. So if you see over here, this is something called as technology. Okay. So technology will have lot of options. So this is basically 350 nanometers. So when we talk about nanometers, it's basically, so everyone has done the MOSFET course, right? So you have a source, you have a drain, the channel, there's a channel. The channel length is basically called as 350 nanometers or 180 nanometers and things like that. But in the recent trends, you need to actually go through the manufacturing books. So what happens in the, let's say 20 nanometers or 16 nanometers, it's not really the channel length. It's basically the minimum feature size of your entire device. And that's what basically it varies from foundry to foundry. So if you want to, it was 180 nanometers, 250 nanometers and beyond, it was basically the channel length. But in recent terms, they are basically considering the minimum feature size to be your technology node. So it depends upon the foundry. You need to actually go through the, or if I have to explain it in a better way, I can actually show you a couple of things. So when we talk about technology node, so I have good graphics that explains, you know, the technology node, and that will actually make a couple of things very clear for you guys. Yeah, everyone has heard of the process, 16 mass process. So basically it's a process where you actually fabricate the entire thing over here. So finally your MOSFETs, your device looks something like this. So if you actually fabricate your thing, this is how your basically devices look like. So if you look over here, this is your PMOS because of the P channel. This is your NMOS because of the N channel. Now now before 180 nanometers and above, the channel length is to define what's 180 nanometers and what's 350 nanometers. But in the lower nodes, 20 nanometers, 60 nanometers, it's no more the channel length. It's basically the minimum feature size. So for example, in this case, the feature size, if the feature size of the gate device was about 10 nanometers, that becomes your technology node. But just look into recently, if you look into the technology nodes, the definition of technology nodes is basically a bit of confusing. You need to actually look into the document. So every process will have their own document. Okay. So this is how basically a fabrication thing looks like. Okay. Coming back to the labs, will the first step is basically to so now basically this is the way you connect to your technology. So it could be Intel, it could be Samsung, it could be TSMC. It could be some foundries. It could be SCL also. So it could be some other foundry. Now today I have to connect my design to one of the foundry. I'm trying to fabricate my design. So what I'll do, I'll connect to OSU 018. So OSU stands for Oklahoma State University. It's one of the university that has open sourced their own IPs. So it's one of the small foundries. So I connect to the foundry using OSU 018. And then I want to connect to one of the designs. So in this case, let's say I'll take a design called as UART. I have shown the UART, one of the peripheral. So let's take a small one so that the runtimes are pretty low. So we'll take one of the behavior verilog netlist. So I have a lot of verilog netlist over here. I'll take one of the netlist which is the UART. Okay, and this is one of the processes. So if I show you how does the UART looks like, it will look something like this. Okay, so this is the behavior. This is by IIT Madras. So this is the behavior. How does the behavior of a UART looks like? You can think of this similarly to a processor also. So a processor behavior will also look, the verilog code for the processor behavior will, the structure will be something like this. So you have the input ports, you have the output ports, you have wires, registers. So a couple of verilog coding over here. And then there are behavior statements. You have to assign statements. And there are something. So this is basically, this gets converted to your flip-flops, because flip-flop works on the positive edge of the clock. So this is how your things get converted to flip-flop. And these are a couple of the behavior of the UART. So this is how, so if you take this particular block and plug it in your SoC, it will behave as an UART. It will work as an UART. Okay. So our job is to convert this behavior into gate. Now we have seen the behavior. Now let's see how do we convert it. So I have connected these two OSU, the netlist. Now I'll click on run. Okay, so this was the preparation step. Now we'll so that the step that converts the behavior to the gate level, that process is basically called as a synthesis process. And let me do that. I'll do it over here. So many times it errors out if my day is bad. On good days, it basically runs completely. Can you see at the bottom, everyone? Okay, so now it has been done. Let's look into how what it has actually written out. So let's see. Now can you see this UART? UART over here. And if you see, if you go to the bottom, or if you go, just go, you know, can you see these buffers? Can everyone see buffers? BUFFX4. Can everyone see inverters, NAND gate, NOR gate, everything? So this will behave exactly as an UART, but this is now the AND gate or the gate level representation of your behavior. Okay, is that part clear? This is how you convert your behavior to your gate level netlist. Okay, all right. So this part is done. The part which you are talking about, slide number. Good. Okay, so this part is now we have successfully converted the behavior to a gate level netlist. Now the steps look to be pretty easy, but actually there are a lot of physics that goes behind behind this one, because if you remember, there's something called as BUFFX4. Now there's something called as BUFFX3, BUFFX2. So same buffer will have got multiple types. Now you also saw NAND gates. You also saw NAND. NAND was 2x1. So there will be 2x2, 2x3. So I'll talk about that just a couple of slides after this one. So a lot of physics goes behind the, what you saw was an interface for you to make it easy to understand. But actually a lot of physics goes behind selecting what gates you want to put for a flop or for a buffer or things like that. Okay. So right now we are just abstracting out the physics part and explaining the flow. And then you can decide which part you want to go get into. Okay, every field is interesting over here. So what you saw over here as a synthesis part, that's basically a separate field. So there is someone who does, there's a lot of things that happens for synthesis itself. This one just aspect of synthesis that I've shown over here, but there's a separate department. There is separate, if you go to Qualcomm, there's a one floor who does only synthesis part, because there are a lot of things that goes into the RTL to synthesis conversion. There is something called as specifications. There's something called as constraints and things like that. So those things are taken care of. I just showed you one of the demo of how do you run the synthesis. Okay. Next, you have to do the floor planning. So when you say floor planning, it's an arrangement of the pins. So remember, we had the package coming out, then we had the pads coming out, and then things like that. So we have to arrange those pads, and that arrangement is basically called as the floor planning stage. And then floor planning also, there is a difference. There are a couple of more things that happens in floor planning. It's basically you have to power your chip. So those power lines and power routes are basically done in the floor planning stage. Okay, that's basically called as floor planning. This is basically a part which decides the shape of your chip. It can be a square chip, it can be a rectangle chip, or it can be whatever shape you want. If you want a standing rectangle, if you want a sleeping rectangle, if you want a square. So this particular stage decides what should be the shape of your chip. So if you say if you in your mobile phone, you will have some rectangle chips also, and you will have some square processors also. So this is the stage that will decide what is the shape of your chip will look like. Okay, so let's do floor planning. We'll do floor planning lab quickly. Okay, so let's do that. So now there are a couple of, if you see over here, there are some pins over here. There are some pins at the left side and the right side. This basically pins also, the location of the pins also is something which a designer decides. So we'll take one such pin, one such important pin, let's say clock. We'll try to take because clock is very important for the entire chip. So we'll take one such pin called as clock, and we'll try to place the clock and see whether it places it rightly or not. Okay, let's do that. We'll go back to the labs. So initial density, aspect ratio, these are some heavy concepts, but one concept which I can explain over here, which will be pretty much visible as you see the screen. So what I'll do is I'll keep this as one. And I'll arrange my pins. So I will take up the clock pin. So let's say there are options. Let's say top, I can place my clock at the top. I can place my clock at the right, bottom or left. So there are a couple of options that is available to me. What I'll do is I'll take my clock and put it in the bottom side, for example. Okay, let's say my the Arduino board, which I designed in the beginning, it wants the clock pin to be somewhere at the bottom or at the side. So in this case, the Arduino board wants the clock pin to be at the bottom. So let me do that. I'll place the clock pin at the bottom, and also I'll place the reset pin also at the bottom. Okay, rest of the pins will keep it default. So let's say the package doesn't worry much about the other pins, but it is more worried about the clock level pin. So let's put the clock level at the bottom, and I'll click on apply. And just observe, just take a note of this thing. The aspect ratio is 1 over here. Okay, just take a note of that part. So I'll run this. So this will take some about 2 minutes. So in the meantime, if you have any questions, we can take up some questions. So you can take some 5 minutes break, because you know they want some 5 minutes break. Now is a good time. Yeah, just take some 5 minutes break, else we'll just drowse off. This will take about 2 to 3 minutes to run. So if you have any questions, you can come up, or you can ask me questions, or you can take a break. Just stretch your legs a bit. Yeah. So we'll be going for another 1.5 hour. So you know, come ready for the next 1.5 hours.
Hi, sir. After a long time. Yeah.
I think that Thank you.
All right. So, you guys ready for the next part? Okay. So, remember, just before going to the break, what was the aspect ratio? One. So, if you look into the aspect ratio, what is the shape of the chip? Yeah, so basically aspect ratio is a width by height. It's basically width by height. So, there was one more thing that I did additionally over here. I basically, placed the clock pin somewhere at the bottom, clock and reset pin somewhere at the bottom. Okay, so let's see whether I'm able to do that or not. So let's see if I'm able to find those clock pins or not. There is one pin, this is which pin? So this is not the clock pin. So let's search. Let me search for some more pins. Okay, let's see if we have some pins over here. We'll zoom in. Yeah, so if you see the clock and reset pins which are placed over here. Okay, so this is basically an intention that comes from over here. So slide number six. So just remember the slide number. It comes from here. So basically this is my product. So product decides which peripherals will sit over where. For example, if you look into this particular diagram, it basically decides which peripheral sits at what location. And then from there, the pin locations of the process and or the SoC gets defined. Okay. That's how it basically comes from the product level. So nothing we can do over here. It's nothing, but if you ask me, placing the clock over here was not my decision. It was a decision that came from the product itself. So it basically, this product demands that the clock should be, let's say clock should be coming over here. And that's why I've placed a clock pin at the bottom. Okay, so it's all basically product driven. Mostly it's all product driven. So if you see your IoT watches, if you see there are a couple of buttons that you see over here, and that buttons, if you press it, it goes rightly into the right pin. So that button, location of the button decides where the respective pin should be placed on the chip. That's the top level concept. Now let's see. Now what we'll do is we'll go to back to slide number 60. Now I'll do another change over here. Let me close this. And I'll change the aspect ratio to, let's say, some number. Let's say I'll make it 0.75. Okay. So what do you think the shape of the chip will be? It will be a sleeping rectangle or it will be a standing rectangle? Sleeping rectangle. It will be a rectangle which will be sleeping, or it will be a rectangle which is standing. So anyone sleeping rectangle? How many? And standing rectangle? Standing rectangle? No, I'm just sleeping rectangle. Okay, and standing rectangle. And what about others? Sleeping, standing, yeah. Sleeping and standing. Okay, let's see what comes out, okay. So it's a sleeping rectangle, yeah. And even if it is a sleeping rectangle, we should be exactly able to see the clock pin. It should be where we want it to be. If we want it to be at the bottom, let's see whether it's there at the bottom or not, okay? Now, we can conclude on one thing over here. So all your electronic devices that you see, those are mostly, or basically the consumer electronics industry, that's mostly dominated by three different parameters. And that's very important. One is power, one is performance, and one is area. So over here, we are now worried about the area. We are taking care of the area over here. There is performance and power to be looked upon. We'll look that in some time from now. But right now, what we are doing over here, we are actually customizing the area. So customer has given us a requirement that your area should be A, B, C, D, E, F. Now we are trying to maintain that particular area over here. That's where the area parameter comes into picture. So let's see. So students, any queries over here? Any questions over here? So I was talking about that free, this thing, one of the installation courses. So if you go to the website and there is courses over here. So over here, you will see something called as CAD and EDA automation using basic Unix. So there is a guide. It's a complete guide. How do you install the, so basically your laptop, you can convert into your lab. And this has got all the, anyone who wants to, basically install whatever labs I'm doing over here. If you want to do the same labs in your own laptop, log into this particular, go to this particular free course and it should be able to install all the open. It has got a video recording, everything that you see over here. No, we have an image for the OS. You have to OS, yeah, image for the OS, yeah.
You could make that image after you load everything.
But every time, yeah. We can do that. Actually, eFabulous has done that same thing. They have created a box with inbuilt everything. You just install the box and everything will get loaded. Yeah, that part can be done. So it will be basically explain you how to install tools on Ubuntu, how do you install tools on CentOS, and basically how do you install basically Linux also. So how do you download Oracle VirtualBox and install Ubuntu and things like that. Okay. So coming back to the labs. So if you see the runtime over here for this small chip, it was about, some few minutes, but in a real scenario for 1 million instance count or 2 million instance count, this goes to few hours or, half a day, something like that. This is just one small example. So that's why whatever you decide, the chip planning, when we plan a chip, it has to be so perfect on paper that you should spend less time on doing this multiple things. So for example, my customer told me that the chip should be a rectangle chip. But accidentally, I put an aspect ratio of 1 over here, and that came out to be square chip. So these accidents are not, generally, typically not allowed in a chip design industry. So the planning, it's basically called as the floor planning. That is basically called as the floor planning. So that planning needs to be very much done on the paper first, and then we go for the implementation. So let's see whether we got a rectangle chip or not. Okay, so we got a rectangle chip, and we'll try to locate the clock pin. The clock is something over here. Reset is over here. And clock. This is IO. Let's see if I'm able to find the clock pin. Not here. This is reset. Okay, I got the clock pin. Okay, so the clock pin which I wanted to be at the bottom, it's not there actually at the bottom. Okay. Okay, so one task has been done. And similarly, we have to do it for every pin. So in a real scenario, each and every pin that you see on the chip, so each and every pin that you see over here, every pin must be properly placed into the respective locations based on its view from the top level, from the top level chip. That's one of the steps that we have covered. Next is basically, yeah. Which pin should be placed where? Yeah. We can use the tool. So there are options like. Something called as a pin constraint. So over here, basically. Range pins, you can give start, stop. So start is basically, if you take one particular range, this is a 0%, this is 100%. If you want to place your pin at the middle, you give start as 49%, stop as 51%. So different tools do different kinds of things. Synopsis and cadence. Synopsis has something called as pin placement constraint. Some command is there. So every tool has their own way to do it. Not this one, not exact location, but yeah, the advanced tools, the closest tools can do it. Yeah. And the size of the chip will be decided even before we start the floor planning. Okay. Okay. So that was about the floor planning. Next step is basically placement. So placement again, it's basically whatever we did now, that was a mix and match of placement and floor planning. If you see over here, if you see the screen, so floor planning placement, floor planning basically consists of multiple steps. One of the very important steps is the power routing. So basically we want to power the chip, and the power, if you see this particular grid lines, those are basically nothing but a power line. So I'll zoom in and show you one such thing. So let's say if I select this one. Can you see this power line? This is your entire ground line which is present, and this ground line is connected to your vertical strips also. And let me show you that as well. Can you see this? This particular vertical strip is connected to this horizontal power ground lines. Similar for the power line. So this is how your basically the power routing. And there is a lot of physics that goes behind why do you do the grid structure of the power and why not the regular power rings and things like that. So there's a lot of things that goes behind it. That is out of scope of this particular 3-hour session. But can you see the pins and all? These are the pins. And if you see over here, there are alternate ground lines. So if you see, if this is ground, this is selected. This is selected. This is selected in this one. So there are alternate ground lines. It's not continuous. There are structures where they have VDD VSS very close to each other. And alternate structures of powers are also available. This is one of the structures which is being followed in the industry. Okay. Yes. Okay. That's a good question. Yeah. So the size of this one is in microns. It's 459 microns cross 326 microns. Like it's a very, very small chip. That's the area of this particular chip. And that's where your, so we talked about three terms, power, performance and area. This is where your area comes into picture. Okay. Is that part clear? Okay. Let's close this and we'll move to the next step. This is, so what we did now was a placement. So basically all the logic cells that you saw, the blue boxes and all, was trying to place the cells in its particular location. That's what this particular thing did for us. And after the placement, we do something called as CTS. CTS is also, in case of the open source tools, the clock tree. So basically the idea is basically the clock, which is present over here at the bottom. Okay, I'm not in the presentation mode. So when we talk about clock, so clock has got a critical role over here. So this clock that you see over here, the idea is that clock should reach to each and every flip-flop at almost the same time. And the difference, let's say if the clock reaches from this point to this point at, let's say, time, let's say T1, and clock reaches from this point to this point, let's say time T2. So T1 minus T2 is called as, there is a term called as skew. It's basically called as a skew, clock skew. Okay, that's the job of the clock. That's what the CTS, the term is, the full form is clock tree synthesis, and that's what the tool is supposed to do. The EDA tool is supposed to build a clock tree for us. And let's see whether we are let's look into the labs whether we are actually able to see this particular clock tree or not. Okay, so this is the most ideal clock tree that is being expected, but in reality, how does it look like? Let's look into the labs. Okay, we'll not be able to look into the clock because we haven't routed it. So we'll route it and see. So next step is basically the route. So this part is basically performed in a tool called as Greywood. In Synopsys, it is being done using tool called as ICC. In Cadence, it's done using a tool called as Innovus. So there are multiple tools which EDA different in in Mentor, it is done using a tool called as Tanner EDA. It's called Tanner. It's a PNR tool. So there are multiple tools that does multiple things. So the basic concept remains the same across all the tools. Why are we doing this and things like that? Only the tools parts will change and the performance of the tool will change. So for example, if some tool is able to give me a better area, that's how you compare different benchmark, basically different tools. If some tool is able to place the entire design in let's say 3 millimeters, in 3 millimeter square, if some tool is able to place the entire design 4 millimeter square, and if there is a requirement where my product requires a design which is about 3 millimeter square, I'll go with software A, which will give me 3 millimeter square. But that software A will cost me, let's say, you know, some number. Let's say it cost me about $1 million, and the tool B, which gives the entire thing in 4 mm square, it cost me about $50,000, for example. But my chip requirement says that, okay, I can go with 4 mm square also. So I will sacrifice on the area. I'll go with the tool B. It's all basically optimization, whatever the customer needs. And for example, if I'm a chip design company, and if there is one there is another chip design company, if I give a chip which is of the area of, let's say, 4 mm square, if another company gives the same chips, gives the same design in an area of 3 mm square, but if the customer requirements is 3 mm square, he will buy the chip from that particular company. They will not come to me. So it all goes on the power, performance, and area. And right now we are talking only about area. Right now we'll talk about performance also. But this is how the industry goes. It all basically, these three parameters: power, performance, and area. Okay. So now the next step. So this is one of the tools. It's called as the Gray Wolf, and this is an open source tool. And there are other tools. So if you want to look into a list of, you know, open source tools that is happening. So you can actually go to opencircuitdesign.com. I think you must have gone through this site, Tim Edwards. This is one of the sites by Tim Edwards. He maintains this site, and this has got a list of all the open source EDA tools, which is a similar kind of thing, a similar kind of task, which the other companies like Synopsys and Cadence do. But this way, basically, these tools are not, you know, to the optimized. They don't optimize things to the best performance, but they do the task, which is good for learning and understanding a couple of concepts and things like that. This is a very good site. And yeah, eFabulous is the company that actually taped out that particular chip, which I was mentioning about. And they did it with XFab. This is the company that did that chip with XFab. And if you go to their site, I think the chip, yeah, this was the SoC plan. And there was somewhere they have mentioned. Yeah, this is how the entire chip, the chip that we are looking now, which we started with, this is the exact chip. This is how it looks like. And we had also done a webinar on how do you design a RISC-V SoC. So yeah, it is there on their website. You can just go through it and you'll be able to learn a lot. So it's called efabless.com. He's the guy, Tim Edwards is the guy who has actually authored the entire tool sets that you see on this particular page. Magic, X-Circuit, IRSIM, Q-Router, Q-Flow. Q-Flow is something which we are running now. Q-Router is something which we are going to use in a couple of minutes from now. So he's the person who actually maintains all the tools. And Kasim is an analog guy. Mohammed Kasim is an analog guy. So if you have anything on analog thing, you can just talk to him. Okay, so these are a couple of things which are happening in the outside domain on the open source world. And also there is an organization, DARPA. It's a US organization. It's a government organization from DARPA. And it's basically called as Open Road, DARPA Open Road Project. And if you go to, they're also developing a set of open source EDA tools for their internal military or their internal defense projects. And if you go to their site, yeah, this is how their website looks like. And all the tool sets for DARPA, you will see it is there under the Open Road project. They have got placement, they have got routing, STA. I'm going to talk about STA. They've got everything, basically all the tools they're developing in UCSD University. And they've released one of the codes alpha. You will see, so there are a couple of issues even I filed. If you see the name with Kunalji 123 is some of the issues which I have filed with them, and they are actually working on it, and some of the issues they have closed. So this is how the open source actually world works. You upload something on the Git, you upload your work on GitHub, people use it, and then they contact you and So some of the issues were closed. So this error was closed. This was something. So whenever you see Kunalji 123, those are the issues which are filed by me, and they've actually closed it. Okay. So these are something which is happening outside India or outside the whole world in the field of open source. Okay. Moving on to the thing. So the next step is basically now that I have done my, in the placement stage, I've just placed my cells. I've not had connected one cell to other cell. That step is basically called as the routing stage. Okay. So basically if I open the layout over here, you will not see any routing. It will be just cells getting placed. So for example, if you see this pin is floating over here. Can you see this pin? It is floating. It is not connected to anywhere. So basically routing is not yet done. So now that we have placed the entire chip, now let's start to connect things to each other and see how does the connectivity looks like. Okay. But before that, we will do a performance. So we have been talking about area and things like that. So we talked about three parameters: power, performance, and area. So now let's look into something called as performance. So we'll do two kinds of performance analysis. One performance analysis before routing, and one will do after routing. So what happens? Let's say if I want to go from this point to that point, if there is no obstruction in between, I'll go very fast. But let's say if you put some chairs or some stones over here, I'll take some time to reach from this point to this point. Okay. So when there is nothing over here, that's basically called as pre layout timing. It's called pre layout. So because I'm laying out things, it's called pre layout timing. And once you put the stones and chairs over here, that will take me some time to reach from this point to that point. That's basically called as the post layout timing. Okay. These terms are very important. If you can just talk about these terms. So in a group of VLSI meetings, if you talk about these terms, they will feel you're an expert. So just take a note of these terms. It will help you. Okay. So now what I'll do is I'll do a pre-timing analysis or a pre-performance analysis. I'll not do the routing, but I'll do an analysis, which is like, I'll do a pre-performance analysis and let's see how does the performance looks like. So when we talk about performance, if you open the data sheet of these processors, there's something called as 1.2 gigahertz processor, 200 megahertz processor and things like that. That megahertz or gigahertz, that's basically called as a performance. Okay. So let's run one performance over here. Yeah. Okay. So the performance has been done. And now let's look into what is the performance of this particular chip, what we are trying to fabricate. So if you look over here, the performance is basically the amount of time it takes data to reach from one point to another point. That's basically called the performance in a layman's term. So once we talk about performance, that's a separate field in backend. Okay. Whatever we are doing, that's one of the fields, but the performance analysis itself is a separate field. I was mostly into performance the introduction was given about me, about Tempus STA and things like that. I was mostly into performance analysis. Let's see what is the performance of this particular chip. And it will be there somewhere at the bottom. So it is about, yeah. So the performance of my chip is 218 megahertz. Okay. That basically says, so when I say 218 megahertz, what is the time delay? Can anyone open your calculator and do 1 upon 218? Anyone can give me that number? So 218 megahertz, which is the frequency and time period is 1/T. What is 1/T? How much? Which is 4.5 nanoseconds. So it says that I'm taking without any obstruction, I'm taking about 4.5 nanosecond to reach from this point to this point. Okay. That basically generally it means to us. Now let's see what happens when you put some obstructions over here. So basically let's see what happens. Okay. So just remember the term 4.5 nanoseconds. Yeah. 4.5 nanoseconds. So next is we'll do the routing. We'll put some blocks. We'll put some. So when we talk about routing, when we talk about real routes, the real routes are basically has got some physical dimension. So whenever a thing has got physical dimension, it has got the what is the formula of resistance? R is equal to rho L by A. So there is an area. If there is an area, there is a resistance. C is equal to epsilon A by D. Okay. So whenever there are two parallel lines going on, there's a dielectric in between. So C is equal to epsilon A by D. So R and C, if you multiply R and C, that basically causes an additional delay. It's basically called as the RC delay. Okay. So that exactly happens. What happens when you put this particular routes by roadblocks. Okay. So now I'm putting R and C's in my path. Okay. Let's put the R and C's over here and I'll run this. You will see some colors over here. Can you see them colors? Are you able to notice some colors? So these are basically, it is trying to connect the two different cells. And this basically uses a very old algorithm. It's called Maze and Lee's algorithm. It's a pretty old algorithm, but the recent EDA tools, they go for better algorithms than this one, and that routes things pretty fast. This is one of the very old school algorithm. It's a Lee's algorithm. If you search for Lee's algorithm, you'll find a lot of papers, but every router in the world that has the basis of Lee's algorithm, and then every router has been built on top of Maze and Lee's algorithm. Okay. Just the gates were placed. With zero wire loads, yeah. It's called zero resistance, zero wire load, yeah. It will take some time.
How many levels of metal?
This is has got four metal layers.
Four levels of metal.
Okay, so the question was very interesting over here. If I want to connect from this point, how many levels of metal can I use? So every technology node has got their own metal layers. This one, what I'm using, it will use four different metal layers. So for example, if I want to go from this point to this one, I'll run on metal one. If I want to take a detour, I will go a metal layer up. I'll go to metal two. I'll run on metal two. If I want to come back over here, I'll go down metal one and come again over here and then come over here. So that's basically called as the metal layers. So if you want to connect from one point to another point, you use metals, and there are different layers of metals that we placed vertically over a chip. In this case, it uses four different metal layers. SCL Chandigarh also uses four different metal layers. SCL uses six and four. Not SCL, XFAB. XFAB 1-day nanometers, they have got two variants of it, A, B, C, D, and one of them uses four and one of them uses six. Yeah. So this will take another minute or so. In this case, I'm giving only one and two because it's a small chip. But top metal layers are generally dedicated for power. Yeah. So metal seven, because they are broader. So the top metal layers are basically broad, and I can use that to connect to the top level pads. Yeah, bond. Basically, what you call it, that bumps. So in a real scenario, we just run this particular, what you see on the screen, we just wait for half a day and then just hope that the chip works. It is how it happens. If you're lucky, the chip works. So the good part is right now we are not testing the functionality part, because that's again a different science by itself. You're just connecting things over here. That's a different kind of science. Okay. Okay. So the routing has been done now. So we have to check couple of things over here. One, first of all, we have to check the clock. Remember, we talked about the clock tree. It was somewhere over here. Remember this particular clock tree. We expect our clock to get routed to the entire each and every flop in this fashion. So basically the clock, first of all, the clock pin over here, the clock pin should first of all connect to a buffer, and then it should connect to the next buffer and so on. And then gradually it should reach the flops. Okay. That's what the clock is supposed to do. Let's see whether that happened or not. And second thing we wanted to check was, so initially it was 4.5 nanosecond. Now it should be bigger than 4.5 nanosecond, because now we have actually put some roadblocks in between. Okay. So let's see. If it happens, it's good. If it doesn't happen, don't blame me. So this is, it gives me, gate counts. Okay. That's a good part. We didn't analyze that. So in the synthesis log, it will give you. Yeah. So, okay. So the question was, what is the amount of gate count in this particular design? So basically the behavior was converted to gates, but how many gates did it took? That's a very important count that actually defines our area, because one gate equal to one area. So if you have more number of gates, that actually exceeds your area. So it's a very important parameter to note down once you do your area analysis. Okay. So in this case, it took about 3408 cells, 3408 cells. And out of that, AND gates there were 73 AND gates that was used. There is something called as AOI cell, AND or inverter cell, and it used 248 AOI cells. It used about 42 buffers. It used 465 positive edge flip-flops. It used 30 SR flip-flops with the set reset synchronous thing. It used about 479 inverters. Okay. It uses 17 muxes, 629 NAND gates, 203 NAND gates, but of a different type. I'll talk about the difference between 2X1 and 3X1. I'll very soon talk about that. Two different kinds of NOR gates, OAI cells, OR gates, XNOR gates. So it basically gives you a complete statistics. Now, Cadence or Synopsys might give me a better number than this one. So whatever open source tool was able to do with 3000 gates, it is always possible that Innovus or Cadence might do it within, let's say, 1000 gates, because they've got more optimized algorithm. The algorithms are more optimized compared to open source EDA tools, because the amount of research that goes into Cadence and Synopsys, that's a different level. And the amount of research that goes into open source, that's at just a starting level. So open source just getting started up. But this is very good for learning things. You know, you are able to, also it's good for tape out, but for chips which has got like low performance and things like that. So if it has got a low gate count, you can actually fabricate with some effort. You're able to fabricate chips using open source EDA tools. But again, the closed source EDA tools will give you better performance and better area. It might finish the entire thing within 1000 gate count also. That's always possible because the algorithms are much more better. Okay, we're talking about algorithms, there is a book by Professor Andrew Kang, and it's a very good book for software engineers and all. If you are looking for automation, I take some of my notes from this book also, Physical Design Automation by Andrew Kang. He's coming to Bangalore next week. If anyone is traveling to Bangalore, it's a good chance to, from graph to partitioning. So all this, whatever is happening at the backend part, it is very well explained in this particular book. So I keep on referring to this book in my online courses also, because it's a very good book to start with. And something which you see in this particular book, it also gets reflected into your C code or the code which is running the entire Qflow. So whatever the tool that we are using over here, the Qflow and all, at the backend, it uses some amount of algorithm, some graphs and all. So those anyone who is interested in software part or into getting into the algorithm part, they can refer to this particular book. It's by Andrew Kang, Professor Andrew Kang from UCSD. He's also the one who is designing this open road project from DARPA US. Okay. Okay. That's couple of notes again. Just take a note of this book. Okay. So we were looking into the instance count. Yeah. So instance count was about 3,400 instance count over here. And we'll look whether the clock tree was built or not properly. So let's look into that. And if it has been built properly, you should clap for it. Because I think today morning only I'm trying this aspect ratio of 0.75. I haven't tried that before. So if you see, this is not, will not look like an ideal clock tree, but it just looks like a tree over here. So if you see over here, the tree over here, this is the idealest clock tree, which I think the tools cannot do. But this one actually resembles to, this one resembles, this does just look like a tree over here. So it starts from this point, it enters into this buffer, and then from this buffer, it will again go ahead with this, it will reach to the flops. Let's look into the cell, let's say. We'll look into the cell which it connects to. So let's say, if you see this is particular buffer, so this is basically the buffer that, this is the first buffer that I'm talking about. Okay. Next, we'll also look into, we'll try to expand this one. And let's look into what other buffer it connects to. Let's say this one. So this again, this is a clock buffer. This is again one more buffer. So there is again a different concept for buffer and clock buffers. That's a totally entirely different concept. Can you see another buffer over here? Buff X4. So basically it has built a tree. It has built a tree close to an ideal skew as possible. And that's the best it can do. So if you go for the other commercial tools, it might do a better job than this one. But right now it has done a decent job of creating a tree, which is close to what we expect. Okay. And next is basically routing. We just now saw routing. So remember in the previous case, there were floating pins over here. We just saw a floating pin. Oh, this is still floating. Hmm. No, we can go after the buffer. So I have to select the pins over here. So for example, automatically no, it's right now not there. In those tools, other tools we have there. There are commands, you can select the entire clock tree automatically. In this case, you have to go and manually select, do things like that. Huh? Output of each buffer, you have to just keep on continuously tracing it. Yeah, so all the routes are now properly done, okay? So now, so more or less your chip is now almost, the next part that you want to check was 4.5 nanosecond. Okay, let's try to check that also. We'll exit this one. And we will check for this. So that's basically called as the post route STA, because now we have done the routing. So it's basically called as the post route STA, and let's run it. Okay, it came out. So this will be tricky because I'm doing it for the first time for this block. I've done it for other blocks. So can you see 209 megahertz? Just somebody convert it to time. 1 divided by 209. Huh? Roughly, yeah. So there is an increase in the time. So it took me some time to reach from this point to this point. Since this was a very small block, it took about only a increase of 10 megahertz. In reality, it will drop down to almost 25%. Will automatically drop down. So for example, 220 megahertz that you saw for post load will drop down to 180 megahertz or even more than that. Okay, that's a real scenario. But in this case, you got the idea. You got the effect. Of parasitics. That's basically the effect of parasitics. Wherever there is R and C's, you will see this kind of effects. Okay. This is with the parasitics. Without the parasitics, it was 4.5 nanosecond. Now it is 4.7 nanoseconds. This post route. No. Extraction done. Yeah. So it automatically does the extraction and does the timing analysis over here. So since you brought the point of extraction, how does your R and C's are getting modeled in the chip design world? So I'll let's see if I have it. Yeah, it's called as SPEF, Standard Parasitic Exchange Format. It's called as a SPEF file that basically models your R and C's somewhere at the bottom. There is a whole lecture on how do you convert. How do you interpret this one? But if you see over here, I'll be able to show you something. Okay. Are you able to see this cap? Then this something called as cap res. These are basically, you know, this file basically models your parasitics from this point to that point. Okay. And this file was used to calculate the performance over here, the post out STA. This tool. Yes, SPEF file, right? Yeah, this is a SPEF file.
Yeah, but that's just assuming a certain load and capacity, right?
No, this is. This is real wire load parasitics. Okay. Yeah, this is real wire load parasitics. This, the tool dumps it out automatically while doing the post out STA. Your question is? Yeah, no, your question is what is it?
Sorry, I thought the first static one was. Zero
that is zero, yeah.
And the second one I thought would be the post out because each of the gates has a certain delay associated with a certain load. Right?
Yes.
It still doesn't count the routing, how you route
it. No, this one is with the routing. This route is with the routing.
So you don't do any timing with the left file or not the left file, the one which contains the delay.
This is the libs.
Yeah,
that is all there. It's all when I connected to the OSC Foundry. Now I'll show you what I actually did.
So that contains the lib file
plus the routing information. Yeah.
So
it has everything. So when I did the initially this step in the GUI. Oh, sorry. Yeah. So just a quick query over here. So when I did this one, when I clicked on this particular technology node over here, so what did it actually do? It actually went to one of the areas. in that particular area, it has got all the libraries, labs, and things. So I'm coming to this point. Okay. So now, if you look into, so this is basically a tool called as QRouter, which is the QRouter has done the entire routing for us. And this is how your layout and the pre-layout, post-layout simulation looks like. And so the list of tools that we used for this particular small session was Yosys. So Belief Finout was another tool, which is an internal tool. It basically is used to do the half finite net synthesis. We'll talk about that separately. Graywolf was used for placement. QRouter was used for routing. And the layout, what we looked at the layout and all, that tool name is basically called as a magic. And NetGen is used to do the LVS. The layout was a schematic. That's a separate topic. And we used OpenSTA. So there is another tool called as OpenSTA and OpenTimer that is used to do the timing analysis. What we did the timing analysis was with an internal tool, internal engine. But in reality, there are some tools like OpenTimer and OpenSTA, or commercial tools. It's called Tempus or it's called PrimeTime and things like that. So this is what we have done till now. So if you look into this, why we actually entered into the open source domain, why our company actually started to work in the open source domain, the things what for an enterprise, you have a model. So for enterprise, you have Cadence, Synopsys, Mentor, and things like that. For universities also, you get the Cadence, Synopsis, Mentor tools at a discounted price. But for individual entrepreneurs, so for example, if I don't want to involve my company and my college and want to start up on my own, I don't have any tools to, you know, not even to model whatever I'm doing. That's the reason that we came up with this particular, open source. When this is the time in 2015 sometime, 2014 or 13 or 14, when we started exploring the open source tools, because we had some ideas. We had a lot of things to implement, but there was no way I cannot go to Qualcomm and take my design and implement in Qualcomm tools. Now neither I can go back to IIT Bombay and access the tools over there. So there should be some way, some model, or there should be some way to basically at least look into your design. And how does it behave? How does the performance of your design looks like? How does the area of your design looks like? So there should be some way. So 2014 we started exploring a lot of open source tools, and then we came up with one particular flow. It's basically called as the VSD flow. You can find this VSD flow on GitHub. I'll show you that. So we came up with our own flow where we took the design from at the C level. So at the C, you basically write your behavioral thing. Then you convert that C to RTL using a tool called as Ahir. So it was developed by Professor Madhav Desai. Now the tool is basically called as AA. It's called AA. Then you have RTL to synthesis. We just did the RTL to synthesis part using Yosys. Then from synthesis to placement, we did using Graywolf. CTS also we did using synthesis and placement. CTS also we did. We did the clock tree thing using the Graywolf, and routing we used QRouter. And then we have to do the STA part. There are a couple of tools to do the STA. one is a tool called as OpenTimer. One is OpenSTA, and the one which we used for showing the numbers, that is basically called as the Vesta and then EC also, there is a tool called as, so one tool is OpenTimer, and there's another tool developed by DARPA. It's called Triton CTS. It's called Triton Sizer. I'll talk about that separately. So that basically framework is basically called as the VSD flow. And if you want to download VSD flow, you can just go to the GitHub. Basically, you can do a Google search. So that flow is pretty much famous among students. If you go to the Google search for GitHub or GitHub space VSD flow, excuse me, you can see the VSD flow solution present over here. The entire scripts and everything are there, and the steps to run the VSD flow. Basically, these are the steps. How do you run the open source EDA tools and test and verify whether the tools have been working correctly or not, and yeah, things like that. So you'll find the entire solution on VSD flow. That's how we came up with the solution of VSD flow, and this is basically accepted in one of the IEEE paper. If you search for IEEE, it's one of the IEEE paper for. It was named as technology mediated tutorial, because that time we had gone to Shanghai and they were looking for some papers specifically for learning. So this problem is there worldwide, where people are not able to learn things on their own. That's where they were looking for some papers, and that was the moment where we actually came up with this particular tool. It's a Tickle utility. It's written in Tickle program. It's called EDA. We call it as an EDA management system. It's basically it does a lot of things. You just go through the readme of the that one, and it this was selected as an IEEE in Shanghai, China. 11-12 March was the conference. Yeah, this is the entire detail. You'll find all of them on this IEEE paper. Okay. Yeah.
Actually, you have access to it, right?
Yeah, I have access to it. Yes. Okay, so that's more towards the startup point of view, because I was looking for solutions. I didn't find it, so I built my own solutions. It's mostly the way the startups operate. Okay, next I've done a good comparison about Synopsys, Cadence, Mentor, Ansys, and what OpenSource provides you. So for example, in the Synopsys, if you have Spyglass or Lint in OpenSource domain, it's a tool called as QMZ Fuzzer. It's under development. So there's a company called a Symbiotic EDA. Let me expand. Okay. So for every tool over here, there is some solution available in the web. You just might want to go into and look into it. So for Synopsys Lint, there is something called as QMZ Fuzzer. For CDC, it's a clock domain checking. So all these, what you see over here, these are nothing but the steps that we did some time back, and each and everything is a different field by itself. Okay. So we looked into, there is something called as VCS in Synopsys. They have something called as VCS or Questa Sim in Mentor, and that's basically called as the VLang. So VLang is another tool which was developed by an Indian entrepreneur. He stays in Noida, Puneet Goel, and he's the person who actually coded one of the open source EDA tools for the front end part. And it's generally used for verification methodologies. It's basically called as, if you want to verify a couple of things, for example, if your design, if you want to verify whether it works as a processor or not, there is some methodology for that. And this person named Puneet Goel has developed his own tool, in-house tool. It's called EUVM now. For synthesis, you have Genus and you have Yosys. For formality, you have Symbiosis. For ICC2, you have Proton. Primetime, you have OpenTimer or OpenSTA or Vesta. For this kind of set of tools, we just did magic. We just saw what magic does for Virtuoso and thing. Yeah, this is a very good tool mapping. And clock domain checking. So basically, Puneet will explain that. No, Puneet, the one is sitting next to you. he'll talk about your talk is about this one or not motivational. Okay. So I'll talk about it. It's a separate domain itself. So when two different clocks cross, at that time, what do you do? So it basically checks for those kind of things. So flip-flop one is clocked by clock one, for example. Flip-flop two is clocked by clock two. These two domains are crossing. So how do you check this kind of things? No, CR pair is different. CR pair is different. This is basically clock domain crossing. So if there is a launch flop, there's a capture flop. This is launch is given by one clock. This is given by other clock. So there is a clock domain crossing over here. So how do you analyze this kind of things? That is being done by the CDC. DFT is the scan chain, basically for scanning. It has spice, it has magic, it has the layout also. It has got everything, the electric. It's a tool. Yeah, it's a entire bag. Yeah. NGSpice is there, and for inside electric, you have it's a spice. It's not NGSpice, it's LTSpice, I think. I don't exactly remember. Again, it's an open source, but yeah, some spice simulator is there inside it. Okay, so every tool that you see over here, it's a separate domain by itself. And what we saw a mix and match of each and every tool over here. Okay. Now demo, we saw this as a demo. We saw these blue boxes coming out, things like that. So one common thing which we saw across all of these steps was the gates. We saw AND gate, OR gate. Starting from synthesis, we saw the gates, AND gates, OR gates. We saw in the placement stage, the gates was getting placed in a different way. So these gates are basically called as the library. Now when we talk about library has got three important domains. So library design is again a different science. So it has got design, characterize, and modeling of the cells. So every gate that you see on a chip that's basically stored as a part of the standard cell. So for example, if you look into the library looks something like this. It has got AND gates. It has got all the AND gates, OR gates, and things like that. But it has also got the variants of these AND gates. So AND gate, you will find a bigger AND gate. So remember, we saw the 2x1, 3x1 just sometime back. So when we say 2x, it is this one. When we say 3x, it is this one. The same inverter 3x, the same inverter 2x, and the same inverter 1x. That's basically the x factor of of each and every library cell. Typically a NAND gate, if you look into a NAND gate, is how the layout of the NAND gate looks like. And there are various processes or ways to implement this particular NAND gate. Okay, this is how the NAND gate looks like. So what I'll do is I'll just show you one thing over here. So better I'll show this thing in a lab form, so that you know it will be. And you have to remember the slide number. Okay, so when I hit the technology button, remember when we started the entire process, we hit the technology button over here. Okay, so when I actually did that, it actually went into one of the area in my laptop where all the technology files are loaded. So when I say technology files, it's a basically a mode or mechanism of how do you I communicate with my foundry. So if I want to communicate with my foundry, how do I do that? I do with help, the help of this particular files. And what are those files? So these are those files. So the foundry will communicate to a designer through these files. I will communicate to the foundry through this file. So the files are have got so the left is I'll just brief you about what are the files consist of. The left file consists of the shapes and sizes of your standard cell. So if you open this one, it will have the shapes and sizes of so if you look into macro and let's say, so if you look over here, this gives you the size of the, can you see this? This gives you the size of the AND gate. So this is the file. So foundry tells to me that if you are using this particular AND gate, this is the area. That's what foundry tells to me. Now the same AND gate, if I want to get the delay. So what you saw in the left, that was in for defining the area of the chip. Now what you see if I want to calculate the performance or measure the performance, the 4.5 nanoseconds or 4.7 nanoseconds, to get that number, the foundry communicates me the delay of the AND gate. And it communicates in the way that the file, which is, it's basically called as a lib file. So in this particular lib file, you will see, let's say for an AND gate, it will give you all these numbers, cell rise delay, cell rise delay and cell fall delay. So this is how the delays are getting communicated to me from the foundry. The tool that we're using that takes this particular number, that takes the number from the .lib file, it takes the number from the parasitics, and then basically does some calculation and gives me the performance number. Okay, is that part clear? That's how I basically communicate with the foundry. Every foundry will have their own .lib and .lib file. For example, I have this different time concept technology. I have SCL 180 nanometers. I have OSU 500 nanometers. I have 350 nanometers OSU. And so every foundry will have their own specs. And this is how I basically connect to my foundry. Okay. And finally, after doing all of them, let's go back to the. So now we have done the placement, routing, and there are a couple of other checks which you actually didn't do. Those are basically called as the DRC and LBS checks. We'll just skip that for a moment. The idea which I wanted to convey is this. Is it coming? Okay. So what we did for just small block, the entire thing is basically done for a chip, and it will look. So this is basically how the entire chip looks like. So these are the what you see over here. These are the pads which we haven't even touched now. What we did, something for this particular block. This is the memory, analog cells, and time. This is basically how your entire chip looks like. This is basically XFAB 018 Germany, taped out. This was 1.5 cross 1.5 mm. Yeah. Who's? That was 0.4 by 0.5. Yeah, this was 1.5 cross 1.5 in that range. So what we, yes. So what we just saw, the area of that one was 0.4 cross 0.4 cross 0.35, and this one was 1.5 cross 1.5. So that point, the block that we did, that will sit somewhere. You know, it will take some small area of the chip. Okay, and that's how your bigger chip actually looks like. And this is a real chip. This was something which was taped out this year itself. XFAB 180. So this was used only for serial communication. This chip didn't do anything. It is used only for serial communication and some ADC related things. So basically you, so sensors, basically it was mostly used for sensors. There was a sensor that it was talking to. So there is a board on which there was a sensor and you take your hand close to that sensor, it will give you some analog signals. This chip was only for that. It's process, basically. Process, yeah, just processing the thing. It takes the data from the memory, RISC-V processes it, sends it back to the memory outside. This was a very basic chip for IoT kind of applications. So they had a project from defense where they wanted to create sensors, sensor based processors. So they used this one. So for sensors, you generally don't need anything. You just need a very small instruction set. They used some limited number of instruction sets. They didn't use the whole set of bunch of instructions. Yeah. In this core, it was possible. So the Pico RV32 core that they use, there is a way you can plug in, plug out some of the instructions and do things. So there is, I'll show you the code also, the Pico RV32. Yeah. So RISC-V allows you. So if you want to add an instruction, you have to basically write a document for that, send it to the organization. They will approve it whether this instruction really is needed or not. And then they will ask you to implement it. And that becomes a part of the standard instruction set. That is possible. In RISC-V, it's possible because it's open source. It's not IP. So instruction no IP in case of RISC-V. So you can. Yeah, you have to take an approval. If they approve, then only that will go as a part of their own instruction set. Yeah. There is a process. IIT Madras has been doing that for a couple of years now. They have, in fact, many of the instructions that you see for RISC-V, a couple of them are from IIT Madras itself, from India. Yeah. They've been working on it since 2011. Yeah. Okay. After you do all this, what I showed you a performance analysis, that was just a part of it. In detail, if you want to do a performance analysis, there are different kinds of checks. So what we did now was a reg to reg. We saw a performance between a flop to a flop. In reality, there are a couple of more checks that we do. There's something called as in to reg. There's something called as reg to out. There is something called as in to out. And in fact, even that's not all. There are something more to it. So you do this, there is something called as clock gating checks. There's something called as, so this detail will be covered in a separate session. There's something called as recovery removal. There's something called as, data to data checks. Then there is something called as latch timing. There is something slew analysis. So data slew and clock slew analysis. There is something called as load analysis. There is something called as fan out and max capacity analysis. So these are the kinds of analysis that is being done by a separate team. Clock analysis is also, we just saw a skew kind of analysis just now. I talked about skew, and there's something called as skew analysis. There's something called as pulse width analysis. Okay. Once you do all of them, you basically do all of them. And then if all the checks pass, then you're actually ready for a tape out. And this is the process why it takes about a year or so. So what we did in last 2 or 3 hours, this is the process actually that people actually spend years to do the entire thing. Okay. So in fact, yeah. So basically manufacturer. So basically if you want to manufacture a chip, so these are the things that you need to do. If this thing passes, then only, so it's like a 4-year degree. So 4 years, you pass semester 1, semester 2, semester 3, semester 4, and then hope that you get a job. So similar, it's like this. So you do this 3-4 months or 1 year of rigorous work, and then just hope that the chip works after it comes from the foundry. And if it doesn't work, then there are alterations. So what we do generally in industry, there is a concept called test chips. So basically before taking the product to the customer, they first produce some test chips. They basically test whether all the blocks which is being which they are going to manufacture, they're working correctly or not, things like that. That's why there's a process called as test chips, and they basically create some, they basically manufacture the final chip after some 2 or 3 years of test chip, 2 or 3 test chips. After 2 or 3 test chips, they actually go for the main chip. This is how basically, so all the mobile phones and all the laptops that you see, the chips that is working on your laptops, they actually gone through a process of 3 to 4 years of testing, or basically these are basically what is the test chips, and then they're actually manufactured on the real. So design cycle is pretty huge. And we have covered the design cycle in 2.5 hours. Okay. All right. And now a couple of things that we have been doing. So I'm not alone in this journey. In the open source EDA domain, it's not that only that I am doing. So now what I'll be showing you is a couple of events that we have done all over the world and all across India also. So one of the events that we generally do is it's called a VSD Open Conference. So what does this conference do? So for example, if some of you now that you know the how does the tool works and things like that, if you go back home and use the tools and do something which is different than the regular thing, you can publish actually a paper in our conference. So in our conference, what happens, there are speakers who comes from outside who are actually working in the open source domain for last couple of years. Professor Andrew Kang is one of the person who has been who has actually coded the Cadence tools during the inception 1984. When the Cadence tools actually came up, he was a major resource person for coding the some of the very good algorithms for the Cadence tools. So Professor Andrew Kang is now working on the open source tool set. He was one of the keynote speaker. Calista Redmond is the CEO of RISC-V Foundation. So the one who is heading the RISC-V organization. So if you create new instructions, you need to take an approval from Calista, and she will approve that, okay, this actually can go in a chip. Daniel Lenny, anyone knows Daniel Lenny, semiconductor industry, anyone knows Daniel? So if you go to his website, semiwiki.com, it's a blog. So it's a blogging site, but that's the best blogging site in the semiconductor world. So basically all your queries related to jobs, related to IPs, related to design and things like those basically gets answered in this particular website. It's called semiwiki.com. And he's a very huge personality. He already had 3 to 4 startups, two of them, which he sold off, and he made a lot of money in that, and a couple of startups also failed for him, but that's fine. And then towards like 2011, he launched this particular website for freshers, for engineers, just like you and me, because I was a fresher 2010, 2009, I was also a fresher. And he realized the need for all this information to be passed on to the fresher. So he created this website, semiwiki.com. So all your queries related to, you know, related to jobs and things like that will be answered in this site. And he was a keynote speech in our conference. Then Tim Edwards is the architect of all the open source EDA tools. He was chairing the conference. And the good part about this conference is it's an online conference. So people sitting over here can actually attend this particular conference from your homes, from your rooms, from your colleges. IIT Qualcomm had booked an entire room just to attend this particular conference in their premises while this was conducted from Chennai. So this conference was done from Chennai. We had booked the hall, and it was completely online. Presenters were presenting the all their content from their own locations. No need to travel, nothing. No lunch, no tea, no breakfast. You just had to attend. You would arrange your tea, breakfast, and everything on your own. And this is the only online conference that we have in the VLSI domain. In the open source VLSI domain, that's the only online conference. Yeah, but those are paid. Entry is free, but the recorded ones are paid. I'll show you the links. Okay. The keynote, Professor Andrew Kang gave us the future of open source EDA and how rewarding it is. The ways you can make money using open source. Those things was done by Professor Andrew Kang. Tim Edwards and Jeff DiCaprio was the Raven chip, the chip that I was showing till now, I was demoing till now. Those were the chips. Those were actually fabricated. And Tim Edwards and Jeff DiCaprio, they are from eFabless. They actually demoed that entire chip, entire board, and that board was made using all open source EDA tools. They actually booted the board in front of a large audience. About 500 people had joined the conference, and they had actually booted the board. They actually started up that board in front of that big audience. Now Steve Hoover is again most into front end. So what we talked about Verilog. There is something called as high level Verilog language. It's called transaction level Verilog. So we talked about Chisel, we talked about BlueSpec, and there's something more high level Verilog languages where you can actually code your behavior. And that's basically the tool which is written by Steve Hoover. Calista Redmond is the CEO of RISC-V. Berkeley had presented their paper on Boom. It's called Berkeley Out of Order Machine. It's a RISC-V processor again. And there are other couple of other projects. And there was a demo by Professor Kamakoti from IIT Madras. He actually presented the first, if you see at the bottom, it was the first, India's first RISC-V based processor. And that was kind of a nation's pride, which was executed by Professor Kamakoti. And there was one more processor that was released by IIT Bombay, Professor Madhav Desai. That's based on a different architecture. So this was RISC-V, that was on Spark architecture. And there was again, there were only two processes that was designed by India. And one was Ajit and one was One was Shakti. You must have heard of Shakti. You just Google about Shakti. Yeah. So this is what. And then finally, I came up and discussed about the status of open source EDA tools. And this is the, one of the visions that we have planned around around the open source EDA tools with IIT Guwahati, with Professor Gaurav Trivedi. He's the principal invigilator of this entire project. So we have planned something like this, and this is ongoing. So basically, Global Foundries and IMEC have allowed to basically agree to donate their PDKs to Indian college students and Indian manufacturing companies, Indian design companies, so that we can actually, so remember that technology node which I was selecting, OSCU and things like that. So now we have something called as IMEC and GF also, which will be coming up very soon. And they have agreed to donate there, provided we do some fabrication in their manufacturing hubs. And this is the flow that we are trying to follow. Nice song. So this is the this is the entire flow. So basically, we have to go for production. It's an inter level initiative where we have to go. That was a good refresher. So India has to go for a production. We want students to manufacture a lot of chips over here, and to reach there, we have to start. We have to basically start from the skill and knowledge. Basically, we will transfer all the skills that we have. Industry has to come and transfer all the skills that we have to the students, and that's what the aim of IIT Guwahati and VSD, our company, has been, and that's the motto of our company. We want to impart as many knowledge as we can, and we have got industry experts who actually give talk on our platform, and you can learn a lot of hands-on. This is just one of the hands-on workshop that we did. There are a couple of workshops that we have done over the past couple of years, and you all can be a part of it. That's how we are trying to. And since it's online, you can actually connect from your room to this workshop. So this is basically called as a skill and knowledge empowerment. And basically, we have seen got a couple of students who are doing really very very good work in the field of open source, and they might be presenting next year in the VSD Open Conference. They've actually, in the last 6 months, we have done a lot of things. We have actually enabled about more than 5,000 students, and we got good about 40-50 good candidates who are able to take up the open source as a research project, and they're actually developing a couple of good things. So you will be seeing a lot of announcements next year. It will be happening. There will be a couple of announcements that we'll be doing, and that's basically because the skill and knowledge, the skill that we are transferring to the engineers, to the engineering colleges, that because of that it was possible. And what you see over here, that was one of the skill empowerment. So what we did was, there is something called as National Knowledge Network. So it's an initiative by Government of India, which wants all the most of the colleges to connect through the optical fiber cables. And there will be one center which will be called as a remote center. And that center will, the person will be sitting in the remote center. And from there, we are going to broadcast to all the 49 universities. And we did one in July. We did one last week from MIT Jaipur. And that's the way to reach a lot of people like you. Because India has got a lot of talent. There are places, there are colleges. In fact, we got students from Jalpaiguri. Anyone has heard of the area Jalpaiguri in Calcutta? Yeah, we have got some students from, very good students from Jalpaiguri. He got now placed in Qualcomm. And there was no way for me to reach him. But because of this NKN and all this network, I was able to reach him. And you know, we were able to communicate a lot of things. All his knowledge was delivered to him via online. And there are 3 or 4 students who got placed in Qualcomm. There are a couple of students who got placed in companies like Ansys. And Cadence, Synopsys, Apple, Google. So they are, Apple and Google is looking for hiring a lot of freshers in the Bangalore campus. So basically, the only way to bring students not from Bangalore but from other areas of the country is through online. So that's why government has taken this initiative. There is an organization in government. It's called MeeTee, Ministry of Electronics. And yeah, you must have heard. It's an effort by them. It's headed by Sunita Verma. I don't know, many of you might be knowing her. So Sunita Verma and her team basically headed the entire thing. So they want the colleges which are not in Bangalore. So basically, Bangalore has been now called as the Silicon Valley of India. They call it Silicon Valley of India. But the good talent are actually there around Bangalore. So we are trying to get those talent and bring them inside Bangalore to either work for them. So these trainings, whatever I've designed, they're basically, industry has asked me to do this. That's why it's all connected to the industry. Nothing which is something which I'm doing on my own. It is basically all connected, and that's why all these workshops that we are doing, we have been traveling all over the country for the last couple of year and doing this kind of training just to get good people to work with us and take up some of the innovative challenges that we are presenting over here. The target is basically to get about It's coming. Okay, so the target is basically coming up. The plan is to basically train around 50,000 students all over India per year. In the next 3 years using either open source or commercial EDA tools. That's the target of ESD Academy, IIT Guwahati, and VSD. That's a combined target. So Professor Gaurav Trivedi is the one who is managing the entire thing. It's all his vision that we are doing. And minimum 100 tape outs a year. That's the target that has been given to us by SCL Chandigarh. So they want many tape outs to come from colleges, and provided you guys just explore these tools and come up with your ideas, come up with your way of how do you design the SOC and all. Unless and until you come up with those ideas, this numbers are very difficult to achieve. It's a national level initiative which everyone in the country is trying to push, and that's why this number are coming from that. These numbers are basically coming from the government. And then minimum 10 startups has to be conceptualized. So basically, once you design something on your own, that becomes your own IP, and you can actually sell that IP for you can actually create some revenue model out of things or design that you actually do in your college projects. And there are examples. So RISC-V was a college project. If you ask me, it was a college project by one of the persons called as Yunsup Lee. So it was his college project and his professor's college project, and they came up together and founded a company from their college project. So there is a space for each and every project in the real industry. You just need to bring out those projects in. So what we do is basically we send out a Google form, and in that Google form we ask the project title, and that Google form goes to a couple of industries in the Bangalore and Bangalore and Noida in those areas, and industries then ask us that if you have this particular solution, can you just help us with that particular solution. And then we go back and connect to that particular student. We ask him, can you just provide this solution to this particular company and see whether it works or not. So if that company finds that solution low cost and let's say it fits in their they're actually ready to take up those solutions. Okay, so every project that you do in your final year project that has got a place in the commercial world. So that's how your startups basically gets conceptualized. Okay, and we are pretty much confident about what we are planning to achieve over here. And the reasons are basically, this is one of the reasons are because we have delivered a lot of workshops across India. This was one of the second largest VLSI open source EDA. So whatever we are doing over here, we did the same thing for a 5-day workshop at IIT Guwahati. It was the second largest, about 42 universities from around 1400 participants had joined this particular workshop. And this is, he's Professor Gaurav Trivedi. And he's IIT Bombay alumni. He actually is my senior at IIT Bombay. So if you see, this was the grid layout of the students who are joining from other sites. You see NIT Bhopal, NIT Jamshedpur, Patna, Hamirpur, Durgapur, and things like that. So there is a big room. So in this room, basically, I present in this room, and all of them are basically connected through the National Knowledge Network. Okay. And next, also we have done more couple of things. We have done the first ever device physics process simulation at NIT Manipur. So Manipur is something which is expanding because there are a lot of good talent. When we went there was actually a lot of good talent over there who were more interested towards the device physics. So device physics is again a different, separate world. It's related to the physics process and MOSFETs and transistors, things like that. And this group that you see at the bottom, they were more interested into FinFET, and they're actually working on some FinFET device, FinFET level device simulations. So they wanted some guidance on how do you use the Synopsys, the CentOS tools and things like that. So we are pretty much confident that once this group, actually a couple of people are actually working on some structures, if those structures work well, so a couple of startups might come from this group as well. Then this is Professor, one of the workshops which was done by Professor Madhav Desai. So he is Professor Madhav Desai, and he is the one who has actually developed that Ajit processor using Spark architecture. And this processor will most likely, it might go to the NavIC satellite that India is going to launch in 2022, the first manned satellite. You must have heard of the word NavIC. So NavIC is one of the India's first manned satellite. They are planning to launch it 2022, and his correlators might go actually in that NavIC. And this is the entire team. He is Professor Gaurav Trivedi. So basically, he is our mentor, Professor Anand Bulusu. Anyone knows Professor Anand Bulusu from IIT Roorkee? Yeah. So Professor Anand Bulusu, me, and Gaurav Trivedi, we are all guided by Professor Madhav Desai from IIT Bombay. This is the campus of IIT Bombay. It looks nice. Then one online workshop which we did like a few months back, This workshop was completely online, and about the entire open source EDA tools, what we just saw, and about 250 plus participants had joined. We had trained 250 plus people online, and there was one candidate over here. He's sitting over here. Binit, where is Binit? Just raise your hands. Yeah, he was one of the candidates for. He's one of the persons who had joined this particular workshop. Did you like it or not? Okay, thank you. Okay. And there is one more in Mumbai. So in DBIT College, Don Bosco Institute of Technology in Mumbai. We will take similar pictures over here as well. Okay, so don't leave the before going. We'll take some pictures. So in the next slides, I can put these pictures and it goes. So this is one of the workshops. So we have signed an MOU with the Mumbai University. So DBIT, Don Bosco Institute of Technology has signed an MOU where we are going to impart. We are going to cover the Mumbai and Pune area where we have seen a lot of talents in that area as well. So we're trying to impart the same skills to that area and see what comes up, because the demand is pretty huge and the supply is less. So we are trying to get more and more supply for this one. This was done like last week from MNIT, and this was the largest online VLSI conference, about, I think, 18 to be exact number. I got this number like last week, about 1,818 participants had joined from about 15 universities. And this was done just like last week. This is the MNIT campus. Professor Sahula, anyone knows Professor Sahula over here? He's the HOD for Electronics Department at MNIT Jaipur. This Thapar University. This is one of the university in the south. And you can see the list of, so the way the forum works is, you can see the list of universities at the left hand side. So this was done like last week. So things are in progress. And this is the pick that we took last night. I think a couple of people in the room. This is a bad Photoshop. It is not me in double role. It's two photos getting clubbed together. Okay. Yeah. So who are they present over here? Just stand up. Who are the ones? These are the guys. They picked me up yesterday night. They picked me from my car. They put me in the for dinner, and they picked me again back to this photo. Okay, so let's target Silicon Institute of Technology as the next hub for the open source research. Okay, and there's a surprise quiz. There is a quiz. Now we'll catch who one was sleeping in the presentation. So everyone, is it emailed to everyone, the quiz? Yeah, I have it. Or maybe I'll send it to you and Monorama. Okay, we'll do it online. We'll do it now. It's an encrypted link, so it will be very difficult. Maybe you can post this link to them and let them reply afterwards. That's fine. No. It is a encrypted link. Okay, in any case, I can take the quiz over here itself. That should not be a problem. So let's do the quiz over here. Okay, so everyone has to answer the queries. So that was the surprise I was talking about in the beginning. Okay, so. So if you receive the quiz email, there's an alias or something. Okay. Okay. Or we can do it over here. It should be okay. Once you get the link, you just fill in your answers. So the first question is, which tool was used for synthesis? No, anyone who's saying not, it was not EOSIS? Anyone who's saying it's not EOSIS? EOSIS? Okay. Let's see. Which tool was used for static timing analysis? Huh? Grey Wolf. Anyone Grey Wolf? Anyone else Grey Wolf? Just please stand. The Grey Wolf will just stand. Grey Wolf, yeah, please stand. Grey Wolf, yeah, Grey Wolf. You said Grey Wolf, right? Okay, yeah, take the roll numbers. Just take the roll numbers. It's OpenSTA, okay? And what is the common thing across all the stages? Okay. And? Okay, actually I framed it wrong. I wanted the answer to be libraries, but clock is also correct because clock is there from the beginning of the stage till the end of the stage. Yeah. So yeah, fine. We'll give it to libraries. Okay, yeah, so I have to. Okay, so once you get this one, just, just for fun, just fill this numbers. And you can actually view your score. In this case, 6 out of 6, yeah. 6 out of 6. All right, and I have just one final slide. So Munrama ma'am, I just shared them this pic. This is what we just taken last night. Okay, so surprise quiz done and that's all. So some of the important references, you can take down my number, WhatsApp, 24 hours I'm available, or email ID, or this is my, if you want to actually look into my IIT Bombay notes. So when we started the company, actually it was nothing but my college notes, and it was a big thick book of 200 pages, and there was no way to manage that book. So what I did was I just took all my notes and uploaded it online, and that website was called as VLSIsystemdesign.com, and that's how the company got started. And people who started reading that notes, they actually started getting placements into analog devices, into companies like analog devices and things like that. So that's how industry told me to make videos, make online courses and things like that. Accidentally everything happened. So that's the inception of my company. And plus teaching business, because so our company has got three different models. One is the workshop models that we do. And second, we also take some corporate contracts. So for example, if corporate has got some research kind of work, they actually come to us because of the IIT Bombay and IIT Guwahati connection. They come to us and we give them some research solutions. And there's something called a system solution. So if they want the board level solution, they also, we also take up that and we try to connect the dots between the IITs and the corporates. It's something called as a research park. It's called as the online research park that we do. But the most important thing that I love is basically teaching, because I've been teaching since 10th standard. I've been teaching my sisters and my brothers maths and my college friends and things like that. So this teaching is something which I've been doing for like 20 years and now. And that's why this is the most passionate area that I basically follow. So anyone, if you have any doubts, so you can just follow these sites and you can just contact me. Okay. All right. Thank you. Thank you guys. Yeah.
Now I'd like to request Dr. Saroj Rao to come up the dais and present a memento to our speaker, Mr. Kunal Ghosh. Thank you, sir.